But enough of this palaver. Let's get the show on the road.
Meh. Enough palaver, see? Meh. Hi, everybody.
Hi.
It's the Opie and Anthony show. And 50% of Opie and Anthony are here. And then, well, of course, we have Jim Norton. Or Edgar, who he's been since he came in here. I never know who's going to show up. It's quite exciting every day, not knowing who's going to be here. Edgar, with his pursed lips and his hard fingernails. I like how Bobby Kelly said they're like baby fingernails.
Yeah.
And they touch you. It's like, enough. Hope he's out. A lot of people speculating. About a child,
yes.
Things like that. I don't know what's going on. Any news
I've heard
on that
nothing.
Front?
No. I think what Opie said, there was a medical thing with Opie himself, not babies.
What is it this
It's time? A weird condition where the skin of your anus begins to seal itself shut.
Oh, no.
And you have to have that, you have to go to the hospital, they have to keep it open so you can still evacuate.
Yeah.
Wow.
Making it literally impossible to shit.
Yeah.
It needs constant attention to keep it open?
Yes, it comes from almost like a vampire-like ability to heal oneself, and the body interprets the anus as an injury.
As a wound.
As an open wound. Yes, so he's in the doctor's right now. What they do is they just take a razor, and they just run a straight razor down the anus.
How often do they have to do that?
Once a day for the rest of your life.
Oh, God, that sucks.
Yes, so you have to use vinegar wipes when you're finished.
Ow.
But wow, no, I've heard nothing. I don't know if they had doctor stuff to do today for his wife. I don't know.
You know,
I'm assuming
having a fucking kid, like it just seems to me, from what I've heard, to be just a traumatic experience for everyone involved. It's just like this major medical thing that people have to go through. Ah. And just the worry that you got. Travis, our own Travis, although completely gay.
Homosexual.
Yes.
In a very flaming homosexual way.
Accidentally got a gal pregnant.
Yes. He was aiming his cock for a man's asshole.
Right.
And it kind of deflected.
Yeah.
And he wound up impregnating
exactly, right?
A woman.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes, yes. Now, I'm just... Were you worried for the safety of your loved ones?
Well, yeah, but we had... My wife was induced,
she induced me.
and at one point, we had a special situation. Like the umbilical cord of my daughter got wrapped around her neck. So they had
always
to, like,
hear about that one in the movies.
Yeah, so they had to like rush her into surgery and like take the baby out. So I was a little worried when,
there's like things like that. And then in hindsight, it's just like, oh, yeah, that happened. But at the time, it's got to just be this.
To the doctors, it's no big deal. It's like, okay, well, you know, we're losing its heartbeat, so we're just going to run you into surgery right now. And, take the baby. So, you know, drink this and here we go. And the next thing you know, like the room's empty and I'm just sitting there.
Oh, yeah, you're like, hey, what about me?
Yeah. To them, they don't panic about it, right?
No, not at all. No, it's our doctor and then, like, five nurses, and they're like, see you later, bye. And 2 minutes later, somebody comes out saying, oh, yeah, no big deal. God, baby's here. You want to go see?
Jeez.
That's all it takes. It's just a couple minutes?
It's literally 5 minutes.
But for those 5 minutes, you're panicking.
Worst 5 minutes of my life.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
How do they induce labor?
They just...
Paging Doc Martin.
Yeah,
paging Doc Martin. Like a toothpaste tube.
It's been so long, I don't even remember. I think
is it a beverage or a needle?
It's just drugs. No, the needle is, you can get like, an epidural, like to calm the pain or whatever.
Yeah.
But,
God. It just sounds like a very traumatic, very worrisome thing. I don't know.
And induction isn't like a 10-minute thing. It's like you get induced and it could be, 2 hours, 10 hours.
Yeah, they're still going to be in labor for fucking hours.
It just kind of gets the process going.
How long was she in labor for?
She was, like labor. Yeah. She was never in labor because they were just like kind of waiting.
So when they go in and say, look, we got to go get the baby now because of the cord, what do they do? How do they stop the cord from strangling?
They just perform the C-section early.
Oh, is he saying? Oh,
yeah.
Okay. Oh,
yeah.
I forgot about that.
They open up and they go, hey, let's get this out from around there.
Yeah.
Let's cut fat.
Yeah.
And
Like, oh, her water never broke, and when it did, the baby slid, and the cord got...
Oh, Jesus.
Got
wrapped. Oh, is that what happens?
Yeah.
Oh, I got the heebie-jeebies.
But it's traumatic.
How long does that happen? Like, how long is that happening before they, like, how long was the baby being choked like that?
A minute.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Like, because they're constantly monitoring everything.
Oh, right.
Yeah,
they have it down to a fucking...
What a bad design, though. That seems to happen a lot.
Yeah.
Like, that whole thing. And back in what I like to refer to as the day. What did they do? They just
the kid died.
Dead.
Probably. That's why
the child mortality rate was insane back the said day.
Well, nature's slack on that cord.
Totally, yeah. Right.
Tighten it up a little bit.
Yeah,
it's giving you a noose, nature. Nature's dumb.
Yeah, not as much slack, you bastard. Yeah. We don't need that much. Wow.
Yeah, that was the worst.
Woof. All right. Well, so I'm still awaiting news, I guess.
We've heard nothing.
I would imagine the process, like, the most frustrating part is that not being pregnant for 9 months, but, like, the last 2 weeks, when it's, like, any day.
Yeah.
Any day. Is it today? Is it now?
Oh, that's just got to be insane.
Because you've got, like, a fully developed person in your stomach.
Oh, stomach. Listen to you, child.
In your belly.
Let's just say it, tum-tum.
In your tum-tum.
Yeah. In your nummy-num.
Yeah, in mommy's tummy.
Mommy's tummy, yes.
The stork put a full baby in mommy's tummy.
Yeah.
Through the vag.
Yeah.
He opened her legs and just dropped the baby in and then gave it a little heedle for good luck.
She ate a watermelon seed and it grew inside her after a big black man.
Yeah.
Are you and Jess trying?
No. No. We're not.
What about that big without condom sex thing you guys have been working on?
Well, that's happening, but there's, I mean.
Oh, boy.
She's on the pill.
Oh, okay.
And, you know, you pull out.
Oh.
So.
Even with the pill, you pull out?
Yeah.
Jeez.
Double check.
How overcautious.
Oh, wow.
Well, I can't. It's an economic thing is mainly the reason that we're not trying at the moment.
Okay. But you do want to have one.
An ounce of prevention worth a pound of jizz. That's right. Oh, so in time, I guess you want a little Sam Roberts, right?
Yeah. Well, who wouldn't?
To continue the Roberts dynasty.
Exactly.
That is going on, right?
Oh, I hope the kid is just fucking nothing like you. Like, you can't mold him to, like, wrestling. He's like, oh, Dad's too violent.
Oh, what are you saying, Jimmy?
I don't like this.
Oh.
He's not even, like, the masculine version of me. He's even gayer than I am.
Oh, my God.
Well, no, he's just, like, from the time, his first words were, Mama's shoes. And he puts them on. And walks around in them.
it's tragic when the doctors came in and told you that the umbilical cord was folded in half and shoved up his ass.
They spanked him and he came on his own little leg.
We've never seen this happen before.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Yes, he shot a wad. It's unheard of. But yeah, it does seem like a very... Because you're constantly worried something can go wrong.
God.
It's like docking the space shuttle. It's like those moments before you actually know, are we going to have an unmitigated disaster?
Yes.
Or is this success for the entire universe?
And then there's...
And then when the kid comes out, he can run around smashing his head on stuff. And
into everything.
He just gets up.
Oh, Uncle Paul. You got to make sure everything's fucking like padded. No corners on anything.
No.
Everything you own is—it's got to look like something out of like a Dr. Seuss book. All these rounded corners and soft things.
Do you have that? Like all the kitchen drawers and stuff have the clips?
Not anymore. You probably did though originally, right?
Leave the poison on the bottom. That's the only way that kid will learn. How old is your daughter? She's two.
She's three and a half.
Oh wow!
Yeah,
little Riley.
Yeah,
she's very cute.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, she likes everyone.
She's a little shy, though, right?
Well, when you're Uncle Pauling, yeah.
But whenever I'm Uncle Paul, I never say creepy things. I always just go, hi.
I know, yeah. It's hilarious.
She was far less shy last week.
That's weird to come in and this is all these big people.
Yeah. Oh, it would be, like, scary, I think, as a kid.
She
as a kid,
Anthony.
I know. She's hilarious. She's great.
He flirts.
No, I don't. She actually
He's
loves
her.
Yeah, you don't want to ever, you never want to hear that. Mama, compound. No.
No. She loves the house.
Yeah, but she likes you.
She gets
a kick out of you.
I'm the guy at the house.
Yeah,
exactly.
She likes the pool and stuff.
But she asks if you're going to be there.
Aw, that's adorable. Yeah. I don't know. And then, it's like you're raising a kid, and then you got to worry if you're fucking that up. It just seems like a commitment that takes a long-ass time.
When did you think Riley was, like, starting to become a person?
Two.
Oh, not till 2?
Yeah. Yeah, because then they actually start to, like, you know, talk and form sentences and remember things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you realize my mother was still worrying about me well into my 30s? I'm not even shitting you. I'm, like, thinking, like, all right, when can you kind of, you know, back off and be like, all right, you know, I don't have to worry about my kids anymore. No. Like, she was still worried, like, if I was...
I don't think that stops, though. You know, like, my dad's still, like, when we'll, like, you know, drive to Montreal to see my wife's family, he'll be like, all right, well, you know, text me when you get there.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't think that goes away, though.
Well, that's kind of like any loved one worry. Yeah. So I understand that part of it, but I mean the parent-child...
You had a higher worry?
...worry thing, yeah. Like, it starts with the cord around the fucking neck and shit like that, and it just continues. You're going to bash your head on something sharp. You're going to drink some poison. You're going to get kidnapped. It's just a fucking worrisome, horrible
thing. You just
don't
want to care about anyone.
No, bingo. I don't want to care that much about anything. But not, like, even anyone, anything in my life.
Your mom was actively worried about you into your 30s?
Yeah, like worried if I was going to just even have a roof over my head and, you know, God, was I a fucker.
Slipping you $20 bills. Like, just save this. Just
what are you doing?
Use it for gas.
She probably should have been worried, though. The fact that you were fucking power drinking at noon and driving an air conditioning van fucking 90 back to work to put a toilet on someone's ceiling. Fucking, of course she was worried. I worry about you now. I'm your radio partner.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess I gave reason to worry over the years. But
was she worried about Joe, too, and Dawn?
No, Joe's more of an independent guy. Dawn, of course. She's like, her baby. Dawn, the girl. But I was just that fucking oversensitive crybaby kid, so she had to worry about me. I was like, oh, she's probably looking at me during my entire youth just going, oh, he's going to be just a disaster. Just a weepy faggot.
She call you into, like, your 30s asking if anybody, like, was mean to you today?
Was anyone mean? I'd be like, Mom, I cried at work today. I would announce that I cried at school. Like, what? I'd get home and be like... hear ye, I cried at school today.
Because it wasn't enough attention that you got at school when you were crying.
Right.
You needed some more.
Somebody was a blogger before it was hip.
Yes.
Ant would have had an emotional live journal if you had gone to school later.
I was emo before emo. Oh,
you're the Britney, leave Britney alone. Yes.
Yeah.
So what happened? You cried at school. Why?
I don't know. There was always something, you know, either my feelings got hurt.
They picked
like
on you?
They picked on me. Oh. I've told the story about the cookies I brought in that my mom bought, and they said it looked like dog shit, and I started crying because I felt bad that... The cookies were, and my mom bought them, and
you had doodie cookies.
Your mom didn't even make them; she bought them.
She bought them.
And so who cares?
I know, but
you're making fun of the manufacturer.
Look, Sam, why don't you just?
Nobody wants doodie cookies made fun of.
Oh,
doodie cookie Cumia.
Kaka Cumia.
I cried at work today. Travis, I know he made fun of doodie cookies. I was fucking. I was the little Fez. Yes, it was very, very harrowing. What a harrowing youth I am.
So you just go home and just say I cried today.
Like, I'd go home, and I actually would wait until it was pried out of me, like Mom would be like, you know, oh, how is school today? Oh, well, I don't know, let me tell you. A little weeping going on. A little crybaby Anthony had to cry. Why? Shit cookies. Because of your crap cookies that you bought and put me in a bad spot. And then I cry because, like Valentine's Day, the girl I wanted to get a Valentine from didn't give me one.
Oh, what was her name?
Ah, fucking cunt. But she would like because I would always get these fantasies built up in my head that I would go to school and the girl I was totally in love with would give me the big Valentine and we'd talk and hold hands and all that shit. And of course, she gives it to the popular guy, you know. And I'm like left there.
Because you had built up the whole scenario in your head.
Oh, did I build it up?
Yeah. And now that it wasn't happening, it's like, well, this whole thing is falling apart. And it felt so good in your head.
Yeah.
Did you give her a Valentine?
No, why would I do anything like that and actually be proactive in my life?
You just hoping she'd give you one?
Right, right.
With the fucking kid with the fur coat and the giant cock.
And the weepy eyes?
Yeah. Fucking pissy eyes and leaky dick. The creative kid with the dolls back there and the voices.
It was a puppet.
Yeah.
Was it a doll or was it a puppet?
That's who the girl's going to want. I don't want the football player. I want the kid doing the Carol O'Connor impression. The fucking
playing with the doll without strings, or the puppet without strings, puppet. Yeah, very.
So you fantasize that she'd bring it to you.
Yeah, that she would bring it to me, and I used to like just fantasize about like romance as a kid. What a fucking fruit!
You really did lock away everything in your childhood at one point. Yeah. At some point,
The door shut.
Yeah,
the vault fucking handle spun, and that fucking combination was lost.
Yeah,
never to open again.
No,
did you just cry in the classroom?
Yeah, sometimes.
Openly just crying.
Sometimes I would.
What a loser.
In front of the teacher,
yeah, and
then would want to, you know, give me sympathy.
Did the teacher ever stop class to ask why you were crying, or like, did you have to make it about you?
I'm trying to think. I did have to make it about me. I was craving attention.
Did you explain to the teacher that this was how you got love at home when there was fighting? You would cry, and that's when the hugs came.
Why would I explain something I had no clue really what it meant?
I thought maybe you analyzed that with her.
I never analyzed anything. It just happened. Like yeah, parents fighting. Of course, I'm gonna just. I have a stomachache.
We had a crying kid in class, and the teacher hated him.
Oh, jeez.
She hated how
he would
just
cry. Do you think the teacher hated me?
Yeah, definitely.
No, I think they liked me.
Because he would sit there crying because he couldn't figure out the math. Because he was sick the day before.
Yeah.
And then he'd come in and we'd learn a new lesson, and she gave him the work from the day before, but he didn't know the lesson. Oh, so he would just stare at the page and he'd start crying. And then the teacher would kick him out of the classroom and make him go into the empty room next door to do his work because he was disturbing the class.
He was a distraction.
Yeah, and while we were all learning, we just heard from next door.
Oh, yuck.
So he wasn't like a quiet sobber.
He was bawling.
Whoa.
I hate him already. Figure out his math work.
He was really like yelly cry.
He was sobbing,
yelling, cryy guy. I was trying to, you know, work out
like
the
sniffling and
the sniffling. Because it was like, it was really forcing.
Yeah.
Forcing it out to, you know, get some kind of attention.
You were like Caligula making the speech when Tiberius died. You had to put onion by your eye to get a little fucking.
Two onion bags.
To get a little tears going.
Whether it was an onion or just smelled like onions. Yeah. Oh, God. It's just.
Oh, poor weepy Anthony.
It is very.
You were crying on purpose.
I must have been like at the time. I never put two and two together like that. I just.
But where is the Valentine's boy? You're right. That not only the crier, but the Valentine's, the romantic, the sweet duty cookie boy. Where is that?
I would just imagine, like holding hands to me was the big thing.
Yeah.
That was a big fucking deal as a little kid. I'm not talking fucking, you know, 15.
Yeah.
Hey, I'm holding hands. This is great. I'm talking, you know, when you're, seven, eight, nine.
At that age, hand-holding is the equivalent of cream pie cleaning as an adult.
It's very important, that holding hand thing. And, you know, there was a very few circumstances that I actually got to hold a girl's hand. There was, a fire drill.
Because you're crying all the time.
Yeah, exactly.
I was crying. I was wiping my tears away. So I was crying a lot. Yeah. Now, fire drills, you used to have to hold the girl's hand and walk out in double file kind of a thing. And then there was square dancing, which we had in gym class. Like I grew up in fucking Oklahoma. I was on Long Island.
I had square dancing too.
What?
Did you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You were in Jersey?
No, Florida.
Oh.
Yeah.
You and Eric?
Did you see
you
out there? Oh, yeah. Take the boat to the square dancing.
Eric just square dancing and cracking the hardwood floor.
Yeah, you see him riding his boat with a fucking corncob pipe and a fucking square dancer's hat. Pretty cool, huh?
Yeah, pretty cool. Swing your partner round and round.
I never understood
roast beef
why we were
and
doing
choke
that.
It down. Promenade your dinner.
I wish I knew more square dancing.
I know, right? Trying to figure out how to fit steak martini into a rhyme.
Yeah.
It was very cool though, because you got to touch a fucking girl in school. It was great. You do that thing where swing your partner wasn't that good. You know, just
elbows.
Lock arms and fucking do that. But there was that thing where she put her hand behind her back. You grabbed that hand, and then she put her hand in front of her, and you grabbed that hand. So you're like, and I think that was promenade or something. And you were like touching her hand. Your hand was on her belly. Mm-hmm. It was on the small of her back. You were fucking, that was fucking.
Did you like that?
Yes. and I just like, and then I thought about the girls I liked and what that would be like with the girl I liked and just holding hands. And the, like I would imagine like long walks holding hands as a kid. I mean, as an 8-year old, I'm imagining things that people do on fucking Christian Mingle. What a douche.
No, you weren't. You were just fucking Michael Corleone in fucking Sicily courting a young lady.
Yes. Young other friends of mine with dart guns, little suction cup dart guns protecting us. From a vendetta.
Yeah, she gets on her big wheel.
She was going to drive the big wheel up to me, yes.
Yes.
But somebody put a firecracker on the wheel.
A Tuesday, Sunday, Monday.
Cry baby on Wednesday, Friday. little fruit.
She like hold her hand, like if you get the girl that you liked, would you hold your hand with hers for just like a second longer? Or try to make eye contact while you're holding hands? I would just say this is more than just a dance.
Yes, I would always try to make it more than it was. I was under the impression it was. She, not so much.
No.
Yeah, there was a girl that I really liked. It was the cousin of the girl that lived across the street from me. And she went to a whole nother school and everything. I maybe saw her once a month. And apparently, I thought we were going out.
Ugh, what a dork.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, she was very, very cute.
Did she think you were going out?
No. We would go, you know, what kids do, you go to the stores, you know, you walk around the stores and go, fucking, didn't have any money to buy anything or go anywhere, so you just walked around the town and stuff. And I thought because we were walking around, that we were going out.
Right. When did you find out that you weren't?
I guess when the girl across the street told me that she, you know, wasn't coming anymore.
I'm not going to walk to the store with you
anymore? Yeah, I thought she, you know, and I'm like, well, why would she do not, you know. If she called right now and I had a way, I would get to where she is. Like,
right.
We're going out. But then, meanwhile, you know, she wouldn't drop everything to come and see me.
You're like, this has got to be reciprocal. This is a two-way street, honey.
Love is a two-way street.
Yeah.
And I wasn't getting that back from her.
Right.
So,
no more walks to the store.
No more walks to the store. No more throwing stuff at Crazy John, the guy that used to push the shopping cart full of junk around behind the stores.
And you'd throw things at him?
Always just something romantic, like heaving rocks at Crazy John, at retarded gentlemen. Heaving rocks at mentally disturbed older people.
That's what you did with the girl?
Yeah, we would throw things at him, but then we would talk to him also. Like, hey, Crazy John, what do you got in your basket today?
Right.
I got plastic bags. He used to love plastic bags.
Why?
We would talk about that. I don't know. Oh, yeah. Yeah, so it was kind of, it was one of those situations where I would always blow things up in my head. Just looking at Rich.
You're speaking of retarded people.
Yes. Let's throw rocks at Rich.
Yeah. Do you like a backwards hat?
When did the innocence die?
Oh, that's good. When did I finally get a dose of reality?
Yeah, like when did it? When was it like, this isn't working?
Let me go through the years. 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14.
So? Around the virginity losing and
yeah.
You realize it's not so special at all.
Yeah, but I would still get completely head over heels infatuated with girls.
Just sit up at the table, Rich. Uncomfortable.
We're going head up there, Rich, you dumb
so
mother.
So shy.
We're talking about,
childhood girlfriends.
Childhood girlfriends, early, like, how you felt and what a faggot I was. I was always crying in school. And
I had a girl break up with me. Like,
how old were you?
I called this girl. You know, I go, hey, how you doing? And she goes, I don't want to go out with you anymore. And I go, I thought it was her sister. I go, put Kathy on the phone. She goes, no, this is Kathy.
Oh.
And she, like, I was fighting her breaking up with me. Every girl
that ever, always works. I know. When you have to talk a girl into continuing going out, you know it's going to be a real nice relationship.
I've had, everyone was the worst. Where I caught the first girl I ever fell in love with, banging my best friend. That was the worst.
Oh yeah. I had one of those, not a caught, but broke up with me and then went out with my best friend and, like, I just imagined them fucking, and it was just a fuck, heart-wrenching.
I climbed up on a roof and saw him through the window.
Why were you up on the roof?
Well, here's the deal.
That's the name. That's the name of a movie. Actually, it was called "A Cuckold Is Born."
I mean, I got 1,000 of these fucking stories leading up till probably last week. You know, she picked me up from work every day, and then all of a sudden she...
You're talking a little older here. How old are you?
I was 21.
No, we're talking like 7
I'm talking like 7, 8 years
like
old.
When you liked your girl, she doesn't like you back.
Well, you liked a girl, and it was like, you know, for me, holding hands is like sex, you know, back then. You'd get
that. Yeah, but you're still dating those girls.
You asshole.
I'm sorry.
What happened when you were 13? Mm-hmm. We're trying to figure, because Anthony was this loving, creative kid, always crying at school.
Yeah,
and now he's
crying.
Yeah.
Who wouldn't cry after their father raped them in a shower?
He never you raped me in the shower.
You'd walk home early every day and go, guess who's dirty, Dad? So what happened?
I guess, the losing virginity thing was pretty important as far as making that separation between just this hopeless crybaby romantical kid and the bitter gentleman I've become over the years. But
because it wasn't a special thing, and you knew Buzz didn't love you.
No,
I don't think so. I don't think so.
No, I know that it wasn't a special thing, but I didn't want a special thing. Like I don't regret that it was that, not some big fucking whirlwind love fucking romance movie thing. I like the fact that it was just some fucking whore that I got to fuck and get it out of my system.
How old were you when you got laid?
13.
No.
Yeah, she was 19.
His father hooked it up. His father thought he was gay.
It's like, let me get that crybaby's dick in a woman. Lickety split.
And what did your father do to you? Threw you under a porch with another boy?
He didn't have to. I said, Dad, why are you throwing me under here? I'll show you the faster way to get to the...
You got laid when you were 13?
Yeah.
You could even get a hard on that young? I guess.
Sure.
You know, I remember when me and my friend, we were literally, this is back in Edison, so I was probably first grade, second grade, we would suck each other's penises, and he got an erection. And I didn't, that used to get hard. I didn't know, my mind wouldn't get hard at that age. Like, I didn't know, I was wondering why his did that. I didn't understand what an erection was.
Wow.
Me and somebody, we'd do that. We'd touch each other, but like try to put it in, but nothing would happen because it couldn't get hard because we were too young.
You tried to put it in where?
In his sock drawer. fucking idiot.
No, I'd like to know where too, in his little hiney?
Yeah.
He would rub it, and then he wanted me to sleep with him, but he wetted the bed, so I wouldn't.
And so did you. You drooled on the pillow and he pissed on the bed.
He wetted the bed.
You actually said that worse now than you would have back then.
I liked a girl in kindergarten and I wrote her a note.
Mm.
I go, you look very pretty today. And she was so disgusted, I caught her eating pussy right after it.
What?
No, you fucking idiot.
That's hilarious.
How do you get laid when you're 13? That's fucking, you're like a black kid.
Oh, no, it was. Yeah, my father kind of hooked it up. I think like...
Which is amazing.
My father probably knew I was just cranking it, like, in the bathroom every fucking night, in the bedroom, like, jerking off like a goddamn maniac. He's probably like, oh, God, this kid's got to fucking get laid. So there was a girl, Buzz. Yeah, I've told the story 1,000 times. A girl, Buzz, who just used to hang around. She's 19. And she was recruited. She was recruited. Big
white girl?
Fucking tits. Yeah. Yeah, oh, there were only white girls in San Juan Capistrano back in the 80s.
So, dude. You never fooled around with a black chick or a Spanish chick?
Let me think.
Blowjob, nothing?
No, I'm all white.
Oh. I used to fuck this black chick. She was so hot. And I'd come so quick, I didn't. And I would apologize, and she goes, "Doesn't matter, it's not big enough anyhow."
Oh, she would say that?
Pretty much.
Wow.
I mean, she already was fucking big, fucking gapping pussy.
Oh,
you know,
man.
There was nothing you could do to that unless you were fucking, you know, Patrick Ewing or something.
Yeah.
And, you know, and she was so hot, man.
I'm just not attracted to black chicks. Just not. I've seen a couple over the years that I have deemed attractive for a black chick.
Lucky them.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But I'm just, it doesn't do anything for me.
Sam almost looks like a black chick.
Sam would only date black chicks.
Are you serious?
His wife is like his first white fucking girl.
And she's a very white young lady.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
Very white girl.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, when I was, from when I was in high school. But I was always in relationships. But yeah, I used to only really date black girls.
In high school?
Mm-hmm.
And you didn't get tormented?
No.
Did you go to a white high school or a black high school?
No, it was probably like 40% white, and then a lot of black and Hispanic kids.
Oh boy,
that would be 60%.
Did you get you get beat up?
No,
you fit in very well.
Yeah, I kind of, you know, I was able to go from crowd to crowd.
Yeah. You were like the liaison.
Yes, that's right.
Yes.
I brought the communities together.
You did.
The Rainbow Coalition.
You're a regular fucking peacemaker.
That's
Look at that. And then you started dating their women. How did they feel about that?
Well, I didn't really date like the super ghetto black chicks.
No?
Yeah.
Suburbanized black chicks?
Yeah, most of the black girls would hang out with white people anyway.
The ones that they expect, the ones that black guys would expect to date a white guy.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then you're so just, no one knows what you are, so it's kind of like, oh, man, fuck it, I don't,
What the fuck is that, motherfucker? Yeah, that.
And you'd only show up with, your hair up, nobody would see your face, and they'd go, that's one of us.
Yeah.
I had hair like that in school, big afro and stuff.
Yeah.
Did you?
Oh, fuck yeah.
God, it was terrible. Big, horrible afro.
Just terrible. Well, look at guys with, great fucking hair. The hair that all they had to do was take their fingers and run it backwards through their hair and flip their head back, and it was fine. I couldn't even get my hand an inch through my hair. My nappy headed motherfucker I was.
I had this
crybaby nappy head.
This big fucking horrible afro, and I hated it. And everybody, and I went to New York and got my hair cut in a shag. The shag, and it was fucking, it looked so fucking good the first day.
Yeah.
And then when I tried to blow dry it myself, it just took off. And now my hair was shag afro. It was fucking.
Shag fro.
Shag that David Cassidy had.
Yeah, that's the hair you wanted.
Yeah,
it's the hair you wanted as a kid like that growing up. But fuck, you just stupid, dumb, big fucking afro.
I used to have so much dandruff when I was a kid.
Oh no!
I swear to God, I would always sit too close to the TV. Like probably, we had this wooden coffee table, and I would rest my right arm on it and sit on the floor. And it was probably from me to Anthony, maybe 2 feet away from the TV. And I actually wore out the top of the table rubbing. And there's times when I would have dandruff. And I would just put my head over the fucking wood table, and I would just scratch my head and literally cake it with fucking flaked dandruff. I had so much dandruff.
Snow globe head.
That was a big thing for me, was that somebody in school would say I had dandruff. I would be so embarrassed.
What kid has dandruff? What an old man thing to have as a kid.
I know.
Anything you
could cure with a dollar shampoo.
Yeah.
I had so much dandruff.
Later found out it was just dried cum from the janitor.
Dude, I was...
Pain flakes.
I would feel it. Like, you scratch your head, you can feel feels almost like waxy when you have so much dandruff.
Oh, God damn.
It was terrible.
Unhygienic.
Who has that much dandruff?
I was very dirty.
Were you a dirty kid?
Yes, I was.
Dirty boy?
Yes, I was.
How often would you shower when you were
I there? Hated showering. They had to make me do it.
Oh, I bet.
Gross.
Oh, I wonder why.
Did you stink?
Boy.
I don't think I ever stunk. No.
Listen, if you had that much dandruff, believe you me, your underarms weren't fucking...
My hair was always greasy. I knew that. I told you when I was in high school, Lynn, who I thought was really beautiful. I was fucking sophomore, and we sat next to each other. And Oh, no, this was, I was sitting in front of her, and I had a crush on this girl who sat behind me, and Lynn was in front of me, and she was going, why don't you wash your hair?
Oh.
And I said, I was just ignoring it like I didn't hear it.
Oh.
And she goes, why don't you wash your hair? And I said, it is washed. And I kicked her chair. I was in high school.
You were lying.
It is washed. It was. It is washed.
Even in high school, you weren't washing yourself?
No.
Oh, wow.
So Aunt was crying, and you were just the kid who smelled like dirty hair all the time?
Yeah, my hair stunk.
See what makes great radio people? Fucking just outcasts.
I would go days in high school without washing my hair.
What?
I would go days in high school without washing my hair. It was really long.
You know what, though? That was the look when you were growing
up. That's true. It was very grungy.
Greasy, grungy, fucking long hair.
I was also told one time by a girl that I should really brush my teeth.
Ah!
Oh.
I guess I hadn't, like, brushed my teeth in a day or two.
Man.
One told me I should remove mine. Fucking rotten teeth. It's horrible.
Wow.
What did you say when she said that to you?
I said, okay.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Oh, what an awful comeback that is.
There's always the hot girls
in our
school.
It was the girl at the bagel store.
In our school, there were some really, really fucking hot girls.
Yeah.
And they all went out with, like, the fucking black football players for a while. Like, that was, like, the thing.
White chicks?
Yeah. And, I mean, they were so hot. Like, now they probably look back and fucking hate themselves. But, I mean, these girls were so hot, and you were just even intimidated to talk to him.
Oh, you didn't have a chance anyway.
Not
a fucking prayer.
I was a drug dealer in school. I sold pot and stuff.
So you got that in. You should have been able to get some.
No.
You just got the skank girls.
What are you kidding me?
What a fucking joint. Yeah.
Yeah. One came to my house one day who liked me. And she knocked on my door. Like, I never went to school. I showed up every now and then. And she came to my door with a heart. And my name on her. And
what, drawn on her jeans?
On her jeans. And I looked, and I just slammed the door and went upstairs.
That's wonderful. And yeah, you know what? I always thought, too, that I was going to be able to get some of these, like, girls that I would fantasize about walking hand-in-hand with. And then the girls that would end up liking me were just fucking, like, you know, slobs or fucking, you know, not the popular girls. I was just as guilty as, you know, shit running downhill. I'd get shit on, so I would just shit on somebody else, like everybody in school does. It's called bullying now. Back then, it was just called growing up.
Yeah.
And there was a girl that liked me, and she wanted to go out with me, and it was kind of a vague thing, but I think I said yes to her. And then this other girl who wanted to go out with me said, oh, you know, you're going out with her. She's telling everybody. I went, really? She goes, yeah, you don't want to do that. Everyone hates her, and she stinks, and they're just bad-mouthing her. And she got me so paranoid that I that second, I opened up the classroom door that she was in and said, no, we're not going out. Like, I didn't want this to continue another second.
In the middle of her class?
Yes, with people thinking that we were going out.
Oh, you humiliated her.
I did.
That's, she probably thinks about that to this day.
Yes, it's the greatest moment. That's when things turned for me.
Yeah.
I didn't have the courage to break up with him. So my friends went and talked him into breaking up with me.
We were going out for a shorter time than fucking Kirk's father was captain of the Kelvin. It's a Star Trek joke.
Oh. So wait, you yelled, we're not going out?
Yes. We fucking yelled, that's it. I was like, no, we're not going out. And then shut the door. And that was the last I ever spoke to her.
I remember when I was in high school, they asked me, these kids...
wanted my divorce settled the same way, but lawyers said different.
Yeah, you just yell into the court, we're like, not going out.
I'm fucking this girl now. Yeah.
In high school, these kids asked me to hold up a sign. They said, walk up to that classroom and hold up this sign. There was a big glass window. So I did. I didn't even look at the sign.
What, are you insane?
Well, I was just dumb.
And apparently, dirty and dumb.
Apparently it was this fucking racist, because this girl was dating an Indian guy, so it had something with a dot on it and some nasty comment, and I held up to the window.
You're like Bruce Willis in Die Hard 2, was it, or 3, which one? Where you had to wear the I hate niggers sandwich board in Harlem.
Which they actually put that in post.
Yeah, they want to offend me. There it is. He had to wear that.
What do you mean?
The bad guy made him wear that.
Put it in during the movie?
That wasn't live.
No, because they didn't want him walking around Harlem like that. Very disrespectful. Yeah. So they put it in posts.
What do you mean? They dubbed it in? I mean,
nobody answered. Very good. Nobody answered him. Yes, dubbed it in, Rich.
Magic.
It's magic. Here's a Rich Voss filmmaker not knowing how that's done.
Yeah, they dubbed it in.
They dubbed it in.
Yeah, whatever they call it, you know.
TGI, yeah, it was the same effect they used to make two Patty Dukes.
They were identical cousins.
Two of a kind.
They looked alike. They talked alike. But they're cousins.
They're two of a kind. Yes, Jimmy?
That was it.
Oh.
I just held up a sign. It didn't go anywhere.
What was it, though? Is it like Dothead?
I don't remember.
He
was racist. That's all I know.
Did you get in trouble? Yeah.
I don't remember. I think I got called down. I was like, yeah, these guys asked me to hold it up.
And they were like, what kind of idiot kid are you?
Yeah, I was a junior.
I broke a kid's thermos and got in trouble. Like, a little black kid pointed me out. And there's been speculation over the years that started my my whirlwind romance with racism. I saw a thermos, one of those old thermoses you used to have in your little lunchbox out in the playground, and I wailed it against the tree and heard, because the glass inside, you know, it was always. That was like a nightmare, too, the thermos with the glass inside. You were always afraid it was going to break and you were going to drink like broken glass.
Or you were convinced that if your thermometer breaks in your mouth and you swallow mercury, you're going to die.
You probably would. I have no idea.
Or if you take a bath with a toaster.
Well, yeah, that.
I used to take a bath and keep the radio plugged in right next to the tub.
Oh, I'd like you to be doing that right now.
I broke the thermos, and then I looked around and I noticed that a kid was watching me. So I'm like, oh, okay, well, whatever. And I was in class, and I was up at the board, and I'm like doing some math problem. And the door opens, and there's the principal, the woman principal, there with the young little black boy that had seen me.
She brought him around like fucking Gene Hackman and Willem Dafoe in Mississippi Burning, bringing Lester around to pick out the fucking...
and the kid just stood there. And the principal, I remember that exactly, had her hand on his shoulder. And he looked around the classroom at who was sitting, and he looked and didn't see. But then he caught me at the board. And I looked over, and his right hand just came up with a pointing finger and just pointed at me. And then she patted him on the shoulder and went, okay, okay. And then walked away and said to the teacher, send him to the office. And I was sent to the office.
What a tattletale.
And I had a, and they were asking me, why did you do it? And I had no answer, like, oh, because I thought the sound of breaking glass is cool. It was cool.
And there was a black kid?
Black kid pointed me out.
His father, John Amos, came home from work all pissed off.
All pissed off for ratting me out. I just remember, too, he had no emotion, no nothing, just pointed me out. Fucking rat. Whole family of fucking rats.
I was a trouble kid. They made me take a special class with
they did.
Of course they did.
I mean, these were the worst kids in the school, and we'd have to go into like a guidance class, and they would just make us fight and wrestle and
fucking fight club kids.
Yeah,
fight club.
I'm telling you. Then they said, well, this isn't working. Let's put him in a lawnmower repair class.
Right? Oh, that's where all the best students go. When they send you to, like, fucking, what do we have? We had, like, Wilson Tech around where I grew up. And it was
BOCES.
One of the BOCES. Yeah, where it's just a bunch of kids turning wrenches and fucking, yeah.
They sent us to another school, and you sent a trailer learning how to repair lawnmowers. And I'm going, you know. And I thought, I'm going to have a career.
You're learning a trade.
I'm learning a trade.
I have a career that's going to keep me with a roof over my head.
Here's the worst thing that's ever happened to me in school in my life. I was in fifth grade, and we're in the lunchroom. And it's mainly black kids where I grew up. And we're in the lunchroom, and all of a sudden we turn, and the whole place goes silent. And my mother's standing there, right?
Whoa.
So as my mother's there with the principal, and as I go out for it, as all the kids are walking out of the lunchroom, my mother's smacking me and beating me in front of the whole school.
Wow, that's embarrassing. Why?
Fucking, because I was trouble. I just fucked up all the time, even from fifth grade and stuff. And all these kids are walking out there. Well, first they go, that's Rich Foss's mom. You know, or Rich. And just beat me in front of the whole class. I felt like Carrie at the party.
Did they laugh at you?
Did they laugh? Of course they laughed. My mom's beating me in the doorway of the lunchroom.
You didn't want your mom involved with you in any way, shape, or form in high school, especially.
High school, fifth grade.
Wow, really?
Yeah.
No, in the lower grades, I needed my mommy there whenever anything would happen, like a field trip. I'd be like, you gotta go. You gotta be a field trip mom. You gotta go. In kindergarten,
would cry until she went?
Yes. The first day of kindergarten.
Look on Jim's face.
Oh, he's disgusted. First day of kindergarten, we pulled up to the elementary school, little kindergarten class, and mom drove me up there, and she gets out of the car, walks up to the door. And I think back now, there must have been phone calls made, preparations with the teacher and that, because no other kid I saw this happening to. The fucking teacher came out by the front door of the school to like take me into the school as my mom turned away and went back to the car. Now, I was under the impression that mommy and me were going to school. We were going to go in and play with fucking paint and have a blast, and then she was going to drive me home. I spent all my time with my mommy before kindergarten. So she turns around and starts walking away, and I'm just like, and the teacher now has my hand, and I turn around and I'm like, hey, wait, but where? Oh, wait a minute. bloody murder. I'm crying, screaming.
You think she was giving you away?
I didn't know what to think, but I wanted my mommy.
You and cried a lot?
I was in fucking... I think they must have thought I was impaled with a fucking rebar through my head. I was crying, screaming, and my mom had to just continue. They must have said, look... He's going to lose it. She must have called the school and said, he's going to lose his fucking mind. He is such a little faggot mama's boy. He is going to lose his shit when I take him to school. All right, we dealt with this before. We'll do this, but here's what you got to do. You got to turn around and walk to that car and drive away, because that's the only way he's going to be able to
do that from your marriage.
So she did
too.
That. Exactly.
And don't come back. Just continue driving. Make him wait a half hour before you pick him up.
Leave him alone outside the school weeping.
From 3 to 3:30.
And I fucking lost my mind in front of that school.
Do you know?
I think I did the thing where every muscle just goes away in your body, and I was spinning around by the hand.
Norton wouldn't know anything about that.
The poor teacher is trying to hold me up by one hand as I just am ready to collapse. Mommy! Oh, God. I was terrible. What the fuck?
When you come in here into the studio, like, you think... Opie, I mean, you think they're the most fucked up people here, you know? But you really are the most damaged, if you think about it.
As far as you go, I think I got over a lot of things, things I don't even know what the fuck they are.
Do you really
think you got
over them? Really?
No.
With the guns and the young kids and your fucking big house by yourself?
Look, every girl I ever go out with is completely legal.
Shut up.
So
your
shut up.
Statues look older. Okay? In your fucking house.
No.
You fucking...
There's nothing wrong with liking younger women. That's like, if you as long as you're not dating where it's... I get that.
I wonder if it's like my virginity being taken away when I was 13 by a 19-year-old.
Mm. It's also like no one wants to grow up. It's almost, you know, it's like when you're dating chicks that are fucking that much younger. If I'm out with a 20-year-old, like a 20...
Here's the deal.
She doesn't want to get married.
A woman my own fucking age? No way. Yeah.
No.
What the fuck do I want to talk to her about? Hot flashes? Enough of you fucking old broads.
And I've tried fucking recently just talking to women in their 30s. Some of them are hot and cool. Most of them, here's the problem. They're fucking, they have these expectations because of how they came up in school. They stink. You women in your 30s that are fucking single, there's a reason you're single. Because girls in their 20s will text you photos and, hey, you want to go out? Yeah, and they're fun. And you will go, like, oh, I don't send pictures like that.
Okay.
Bye. Because they grew up a certain way. They're not used to doing it. They didn't grow up with technology the way someone who's like 20 did.
Yeah.
So they're so weird with the phones.
So you base your relationship on a girl that can text you fucking naked pictures.
Yes. I base my interest in her. No. Not necessarily naked pictures. But I find myself, I'm not willing to drive far to pick somebody up when I live in New York. Like,
no, of course, but you can find an older lady in New York.
No desire. None.
Think, you know why? Because
none.
Because that's a power trip over.
Not
over,
at all. Doesn't turn me on. Yes.
No, but your power trip is being with somebody younger.
Not power. It just doesn't.
Yes, because you're so much smarter.
No. You're 100%. I know why you're saying that. Like, I get the thought behind that.
Yeah.
But that's really not it. It's not about wanting to dominate somebody. It is about somebody who wants marriage as little as I do. And not that women want to marry me, but their fucking clocks are ticking. And when women in their 30s, I have tried recently. I've fucking tried in the last year just to talk, and fucking everyone was a fucking dead end because they're fucking like, oh, I don't know. I like, you know, hey, you want to go out? Could you come get me? Because they're used to guys picking them up. I'm like, you don't even live in New York. I'm not leaving New York to come get you, to bring you back and go fuck yourself.
Oh, boy.
No, it's not about dominating them. It literally is about not. They want things done a certain way, and it's not how I'm going to do them.
Yeah, but you are really a smart person. You're really well read, and you're a fucking smart guy. So you're thinking they can. No, I hate saying this.
Look at the source, Jim.
I hate
relax.
Okay. No, I hate saying this. But how do you think
you can write your name?
How do you think a 21-year-old girl is going to keep up with your intelligence, or you know? Or interest you without sex?
Some
that's the cop out line I've heard for so long.
What?
There are plenty of girls that are in their 20s or whatnot that are funny, spontaneous, smart. No, I'm not kidding.
Yeah.
I'm not talking every fucking girl, because a lot of them are fucking airheads and dummies too.
My daughters can't even fry eggs.
there you go.
Okay, here's the question.
But I'd rather have that and a fun, you know, time and laughing and conversation like that, than some fucking woman bitching about some medical problem or fucking her ex-husband or the kid that she has. Or this, but shut up. Well, yeah. I don't live that life. I don't want to fucking talk about that lifestyle.
Or when they do this shit, when you ask for like a picture or whatever, even if it's not totally nude or whatever, and they're like, oh, you got to earn that. Bye.
Yeah, of course.
That, because they're raised thinking that you gotta earn it, and it's like, no, fuck that. I don't like that mentality. I don't like it. Like, it annoys me. Like, I'm not gonna earn it. I I'm not asking you to earn it. I'm not gonna do that. It's like, I won't do it.
Say you're dating a 20-year-old girl, right?
Uh huh.
You're walking down the street with a 20-year-old girl.
Sure.
Now, say someone your age you see walk. That's gay, walking down the street with a 20-year-old boy. Does that look normal to you?
Gay?
Yeah, I mean, an old man like him banging a 20-year-old boy.
I wouldn't give a shit.
Who cares? It doesn't look weird?
No.
No,
that's why
gay.
That's a sign of success. Like, that guy must make a lot of money to bang that young twink. He must be doing very well.
I went out with a young girl before I was married, and it just... she would want me to take her out to eat and do stuff with her. You know, what the fuck? I don't do that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I don't like wild girls that want to go out to clubs and stuff. That I won't do.
No, no fucking way.
But I'm telling you, I've tried talking to women in their 30s, and every one, a couple have been really fun and sexy, and just we didn't. But like, hey, you want to come hang out? Well, I don't know. Yeah, I will, but I don't know. Ugh.
Okay, I'll give you an example.
Keep wondering why you're single, dummy.
What's her name? I don't want to say her name. That used to be a waitress at the Cellars, probably way in the late. She would be great, someone like her. She's hip.
Yeah.
She's fun. You know what I mean? So you're talking about ladies that have divorce and kids. Of course you don't want to deal with that bullshit. But if you find a 30 or 35-year-old hot single that doesn't have any fucking history...
They also make you feel older, too. Like, as a guy, like, I don't like feeling 44. I don't like it.
Well, don't look in a mirror.
I don't like feeling 44, so I don't like someone who's going to remind me of that. And women who are 35, it's very natural for them to want kids. It's natural for them to want...
Right.
Like Sam, even. Sam's a young guy. His fucking wife is hot, really beautiful. And he's talking about like, was like,
she's all right.
Would you want to have a kid? And he's going, yeah. And like, I can't, even with a beautiful girl like that, I can't comprehend it. I can't comprehend looking at life like that. Or Travis talking about having a baby. Like, it's fucking foreign to me.
He's absolutely right, because you get this lifestyle that you like and you have fun. It's like I said, spontaneous shit, being able to just run off and go somewhere and have fun. That doesn't fit with the lifestyle of a woman that gets up there in years.
See, right now you're saying, okay, I don't want to have a kid. And I'm not saying you have to have kids in life or whatever. Mm-hmm. Okay, you're saying, this is the lifestyle. I'm transient. I fucking travel, this and that.
Yeah.
But do you think you're going to feel the same way at 60?
If I do. If I don't, I don't know, to be honest with you. But I'm not going to date somebody.
I'll adopt a little kid from the Sudan.
Exactly. I mean, it's like,
if he's famous enough.
I feel no need to do it. And it's not something I it repulses me.
Uh-huh.
I feel no need to do it. Maybe I will someday.
Right.
But I've talked to some women. It's not like I've avoided them. And every time it fucking annoys me.
Right.
And it's like, you really think you're going to fucking put all these barriers up and I'm going to work my way through them, dummy?
Stop with your rom-com fucking bullshit.
Yeah, exactly. Really realize the fucking era you're living in. And I know I sound like a jerk,
okay,
but I don't care.
Okay, but take away the whole scenario of the other fucking broads. On you, just you, not wanting to have kids or do anything. Do you think that's a little self-centered or narcissist? That
no,
you don't.
No,
really, you don't. You wouldn't want to settle down. And,
no.
Okay.
No, narcissism is putting your needs and focusing only on yourself. It's not about that. It's just I know what I like and what I want. Knowing what you want and what you like is not narcissistic. What would be narcissistic would be fucking getting involved with somebody and then still doing what I want to do.
Oh shit, that's me.
Yeah, but I mean that's what that would be. It's, it's like. Knowing that I'm fucking immature in a lot of ways. You see my apartment, dude. Yeah. Like a fucking, you know, you walk in, it's pictures of me and Sabbath and it's signed thing. Like, that's what I like.
I had to take all my shit down like that.
That's exactly what I will not do. And I have no desire to do that. Like, I miss my ex-girlfriend. Like, my ex-girlfriend.
She was cool.
She was one of my favorite people.
Yeah.
She was fucking, she was a lot, 20 years younger than me. She's fucking smart. She was vicious.
An older gal.
Hilarious. Yeah, I know. I was really slumming going for the older lady. But she was hilarious. I love fucking her, but just the fighting got to me. That's the only reason I'm not with her today is because of our fighting. But she was much younger than me, and she was fucking brutal. Brutal.
Hilarious.
Yeah, but I mean, it's fucking, I'm never going to find a 35-year-old who's more perceptive than her, like or who reads people immediately better than her. So,
how about a young, hot comic girl? Because I see some of them out there.
Yeah, but you know what? They're fucking flakes. I've dated one comedian who was not a flake. She wasn't a flake at all. She was brilliant.
Yeah.
But, you know, it was hard. I was a hard guy to date because she didn't like being associated with all the sex addiction stuff. And, you know, I understood that because that was not her fucking vibe and whatever. You know, just my public persona was fucking so harsh. But all these fucking female comics that I'm friends with, none of them want to fuck me. And I don't hit on them. A fucking Annie Lederman's a friend of mine.
Yeah.
Never hit on her. Amy's a fucking one of my closest friends. Never hit on it. It's like I don't have that vibe with comics.
I don't shit where I eat.
But it's not, you know what I mean, dude?
No,
it's like comedian's energy to me. It's like I'm such a fucking pervert. It's hard to look at women and enjoy them. It's like it's always sexual. Mm-hmm. And it's like comic energy. I'm able to hang out with comics.
Yeah.
Like I don't look at Amy and go, I acknowledge that she's really a good looking woman.
Sure. That's not right.
But I enjoy her energy a lot. Like I love her funny energy. So I can enjoy.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
I can enjoy their energy. It's nice to have friends who I can look at as people first, and I can charge me to do with women.
I'm telling you, like, here's one thing as dating a comic. They get, like, Bonnie and I were in bed.
Yeah, Bonnie.
We were in bed watching X Factor last week, and some girl goes, I was bullied, this and that, and we just started cracking up. We're laughing, going, you fucking asshole, you were bullied? Okay, because it was your fault, because there's people in fucking wheelchairs, and go fuck yourself with I was bullied, and and no two normal people would laugh at this fucking girl.
Yeah, I understand that advantage of hanging out with a girl, But again, I've only dated one comedian, and the other girls I've been with have all been like that.
Mm.
I won't date someone, and I know you date fucking, and I say this affectionately, kind of psychotic fucking sense of humor chicks. You have to.
Yeah.
I can't deal. Could you date a girl that couldn't laugh at your fucking harsh, awful jokes or enjoy them?
No.
Or being tisked.
No. Oh God, imagine that. Ugh, really? Oh, they have to be fiery racists. They have to really appreciate a good, horrid racist joke.
Yeah.
That's the criteria right there. You want to eat?
Yes.
Because our food is here. So we'll eat. We'll take a little break here.
I'm going to do some plugs.
And
we'll get to
Yeah. Rich.
What do you want to plug? Do you want to plug up my specials on Netflix now?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Jimmy's special.
I got it.
On Netflix?
I'm at Bananas this weekend.
Ooh,
and in Hasbrook Heights. But this weekend, Bananas, I'm at a whole nother level now. But November 10th, Saturday, during the New York Comedy Festival, we're going to have a sneak preview of our movie at 1 o'clock at Caroline's.
Oh, good. Finally.
November 10th, 1 o'clock, Caroline's.
Finally.
I liked it.
Mm. It's way better now.
I liked it.
Thank you.
Even though I wasn't in it much, but I still liked it.
You weren't in it enough.
No, I wasn't.
But... Yeah, you were good.
Oh. I wasn't.
Who was in it more?
Oh, everyone.
Boy. Okay.
Oh, boy.
No.
Oh, boy.
Boss was mad at me.
No, I wasn't.
Oh, man.
Oh, really?
No, we put... No. Are you kidding me? Were you in it more in my movie or DeRose's movie?
Oh, yeah. No, I was just happy to be here.
Well, then if you weren't here, then we would have interviewed you, but it wouldn't have made sense.
You weren't in it much?
Yeah, he was. I liked him. He was very good.
Non-existent.
He's very good in it.
He was very good. Bonnie was really good.
He's up for an Emmy in it.
It was a good, interesting fucking movie.
Yeah.
It was funny. Bonnie was hilarious. You know, you were good, but she was really, her standing in the weeds talking made me laugh out loud.
Isn't that fucking funny?
Yeah, she's very funny. She's great.
I definitely want to see it.
I think
November 10th, 1 o'clock.
Good.
All right.
Yeah. All right. Well,
and we'll talk about the movie poster.
Yes, we got to talk about the movie poster
that we made.
Well, let's take a break and then we'll get back. Do that.
Did you get? Oh, we took the horns off.
Twitter.
That the debate. Are we doing Jocktober at all today?
We can.
Yeah. Maybe we'll delve into a little of that. Let's just take a break and we'll all mull it over.
And other guests. We have Ann Coulter will be in at 8.
Yes. So we'll talk about the debate. The huge debate last night.
What happened?
Night.
What debate?
Oh, it was. Come on.
What we debated letting you come in today.
Obviously, we lost. Terrible.
Fucking double guns.
Ah, take us out.
The Opie and Anthony Show.
Ooh, rock. Why don't you play some Rush? Since they were, what were they, nominated?
Yeah.
The Hall of Fame? Finally, I guess, huh? Everybody was clamoring for many years that, why is it Rush in the... That Rock and Roll Hall of Fame is about a lump of shit.
Sticks.
Stone Cold E.T. Sorry, had to get that out. Rush, a lot of fans were very upset with that whole thing. I think it's such a goof now, because isn't it at some point every band that has any type of popularity will end up in the Hall of Fame at some point?
Well, the NWA is nominated.
Now, how does that end up in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame?
And Public Enemy.
And why would you nominate Kiss when you have NWA?
Oh, boy.
But, I mean, that's just... I'm fine with them going into a Music Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
But Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and Jan Wenner and all those fucking jizzbags, they stink, those guys.
They really should change the name of it by now.
Yeah.
And then there would be nothing wrong with that.
Right.
But just pop call it the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Right. Yeah. Just say we need to make some more money. Rock fans are not coming enough, so we want to put rap and pop in there to get more people in the build. Just say
just
that.
Call it the Music Hall of Fame.
Fucking one whole floor is the Beatles. One or two floors is all Beatles.
I wouldn't know. I've never gone there, and I've been to Cleveland, and I had nothing to do in Cleveland. And I chose to sit in my hotel room and watch horrible television rather than go to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. It just seems like... Yeah. A hard rock cafe without the food.
That's what it is. Yeah.
Why would I bother?
I went there once when I was a kid.
Was it a thrill?
All I remember was Jim Morrison's Cub Scout uniform.
Oh, sure.
It was on display.
Little Jimmy
Morrison. Yeah, Jimmy Morrison. He was always so melancholy.
Melancholy.
He was such a melancholy boy.
How fucked up on drugs were the Doors where Woodstock turned them down?
Is that what happened?
Woodstock said, yeah, I don't think so.
Really? Come on. They said they got the Who.
I remember one time when I was babysitting little Jimmy Morrison. I said, this is your rear end. And I kept humming that while I rubbed his bottom.
You're soft and tight. Rear end.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Now bend.
We were looking at Voss's movie poster.
Oh, by the way, that was just thrown together for this festival. That's not the
look. Whatever it's for.
Somebody pointed out on Twitter.
Yeah. Voss plus taking off.
Voss plus lawnmower. Lawnmower repair, sling blade.
You know what? To throw that together with
all right, can you give us a second?
All right.
He's fucking panicking that he's not going to get to say it.
I know.
You're going to get to say it, I promise.
Don't worry about it. Sling blade, that'd be great.
I wish I would have thought of that. Yeah, that poster.
You need me to help you tote your laundry at your wash? Yeah.
All right.
All right.
Now the movie poster. I know
for that event.
That event. It's not the actual movie poster. Regardless, yeah. It's something you had to sign off on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We were commenting on how your acting even sucks in a poster.
We don't like the fact that you're looking over your shoulder and your picture's as big as Bonnie's.
Yeah.
Well, because I was involved as much as her. I
understand.
Well, Spielberg was involved in Jaws. He wasn't on the fucking in the water with the girl. Fucking swimming.
Listen, you jackass. I'm throughout the movie, too,
though. Got that. We know that.
Okay. Yeah.
So is Roy Scheider. So is fucking Robert Shaw.
Yes. Yeah. Look at it. If you can come up with a better idea by November 10th.
I have a better idea.
What is it?
A much bigger, it's a giant poster of Bonnie.
Yeah.
You're much smaller.
Yeah.
Defacing the poster. I like the idea of that. But you're small, and like there's like a ladder up against the wall or something. Like you've climbed up and done it, but you're much smaller. Yeah. She should be the main focus of the poster, and you should be defacing it on a smaller level than that. Okay. Your head should not be the same size as her.
Agree. I mean, I agree with you, and I said, but you don't like the whole idea of the wall with the names on it and stuff.
I didn't even see the names, to be honest. I didn't even notice.
Oh, boy.
No, I don't think that's a bad idea. There's a way to. I would make them probably written a little bit more clearer so people know
what
that is.
It was hard. Black wouldn't stand out.
No, I know. It's hard because I didn't know what it was. I looked at the poster. I didn't realize those were names. Let me see what my name is. I was kidding. I didn't think it was there.
The color correction on it's terrible on there.
You know what we did?
What?
We were in the house. We go, we need a poster quick. That's what Caroline said. We need a poster quick.
Uh-huh.
So we fucking took a picture in wherever, and we sent it to the guy. We said, rip something off the internet of Bonnie and throw a poster together. And the kid is good. I mean, he did it he did what we told him. So I do agree with Norton that I shouldn't be that big with her. But it's only for the November 10th.
But you should you got time. It's only, I just like the idea of you being like a full body shot of you almost. Like she's on a giant
billboard almost.
Yeah, or on a wall. I like the wall idea. And you just stand there kind of looking up and you've got paint or whatever.
Yeah.
Maybe Rich should be writing Women Aren't Funny over Bonnie.
Oh, man.
That's a great idea. I was going to say that. Richard.
That's a good idea. No, they're both good ideas, and we just...
That's great,
together.
Travis. Richard.
I like that.
He likes Edgar.
Gets the point across of what the whole thing's about.
That's great. Yeah,
that is a good idea.
Fuck, Travis comes up with the idea.
God damn Travis.
The mustache and horns.
We'll talk to our poster guy today.
Yeah, it's just you say to your poster guy, look, redo. Where does it say women aren't funny there? Oh, at the top. Okay.
Yeah. But, I mean... arguably hilarious.
It's not to give the wrong impression of the movie,
uh-huh.
you know, because it's not a fucking empowered movie, so we don't want people to think, oh, you know, we want them to think it's just a fucking dumb comedy. You know what I mean?
Right.
Well, then put, yeah, maybe, why arguably hilarious?
I don't know. That's what Bonnie came up with, and she's more of a writer than I am. But we took the horns off.
Women aren't funny. Maybe in parentheses or something you put, or are they? Something different.
Or are they?
Ooh. So now you know what the whole movie's about. Women aren't funny.
I like this little spitballing.
Or are they?
This is, you know what? This is like a writing room.
Yeah.
So you've heard.
I know. Oscars. Anyhow.
That's true. Women aren't funny, or are they, or something.
That's good. Or
because that tells you what the whole movie's about. Or are they? It's about fucking... This is what this is about.
That's good. I like this, Dale from Sydney. Women aren't funny, period. And then you have the period made with a tampon that's been thrown against the wall. Period. Get it? They bleed from their coats. Well, I'm sure you'll sort that whole thing out.
Yeah, Jack, thank you. Those are good ideas. I'm bringing them. I like the latter. I like yours.
Yeah.
I don't like anything about you.
No, of course not.
Hey,
do you know we are 8 years in satellite radio?
Oh, my God, as of today.
Today, 8 years in satellite radio.
Nobody cares about you guys.
Worst.
No, that's what I meant by saying 8 years in satellite radio. Nobody cares about us.
Fucking bounced around more than a step kid.
Oh,
Forster
boy.
Kid.
Forster kid?
Forster. Forster so, kid.
You know, I wish do we have our first break on satellite radio?
Oh, man. We do have that?
Can we hear the beginning of that? Fucking, do you remember?
It's all nervous.
I remember... me, you, and Ope walking when I think you guys had signed, and we were talking.
Well, you rock.
And you were joking about, we were talking about something, and you said, I was really nervous about coming back on the air. And we were joking about something, and you said, yeah, with his old man equilibrium, and you were making fun of somebody. And that, when you said that, it just reminded me of what was fun. I was like, okay, everything's going to be good.
Oh, wow, really?
Yeah, it was some weird moment in the street. And we went into fucking XM, the old XM building.
Yeah.
And had that meeting on the fucking speakerphone with Elo wasn't there yet.
Fuck.
Do you remember that?
Yeah.
That fucking big, big weird conference phone that it looked like a fucking jellyfish in the middle of the table.
Those dumb conference phones. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, God, that was fucking a long time ago. Jesus Christ.
When you guys went down to D.C. to sign. And yep. I met Opie at the train station when he came back. Cause I was so I was desperate. It's like you. And he told me, all right, we signed. And then he told me we're doing mornings, and I kept trying. I was like, mornings. I'm like, can't we do afternoons? And he goes, no, we got to do mornings. We got to do them.
Wish.
He was right, but I mean, that's how I found out.
I wish it was fucking afternoon.
Oh, everybody does.
It was so much easier.
Yeah.
Oh, God, was that a cake job.
But I get more fucking done in the morning. Like,
absolutely. I would just be sleeping. That's it. That's all I would do, afternoon drive. I would wake up at noon, maybe, 1, get in here and do the show, get home, maybe go back to sleep.
What is the first break?
Let's
hear this.
First words on XM.
First words 8 years ago today.
There was a camera crew in there, or a guy with a camera filming.
God, something about a camera.
Yeah.
All right, let's give it a listen. Doing this forever.
I have no idea what's going on. Is the Rage Against the Machine music still playing? What a great way to start our brand new careers at XM Satellite Radio.
Tripping over ourselves.
Now I don't hear the music, but I think we're live on the air, right? All right. Well, welcome to the Opie and Anthony Show.
Yes, indeed. Welcome.
What a cluster F.
What happened?
Now it's good?
But we can't hear the music.
We can't hear the music. Rage music. Like, we like talking over the Rage Against the Machine music. Oh, my God. It just ended, so okay, here we go. There's like 50 people looking at us, and we have no effing idea what's going on. It's the Opie and Anthony Show on XM Satellite Radio, Anthony.
Hey, hold on.
Yes.
Why isn't he cursing?
I don't know. Old habits die hard, I guess. It was our first break.
That's kind of like effing. Yeah. You could curse.
Yeah.
But,
and we did.
Yes, and we still do. okay.
I think we got the first curse out during the first break. I don't remember.
We probably did. We probably would. All right, let's continue.
Yes, yes. Back after a short break. We're finally back. My God.
About 2 years worth of break.
Wow.
Ugh. And these guys just put the studio together literally 5 minutes ago.
Ago? They're still putting it together.
Yeah, that's true.
We're sitting in the midst of a bunch of construction and electronics that are surrounding us right now.
Right.
I'm in front of a jumbotron.
Yeah, you
pretty
look
much what I can describe
look,
this as.
You look completely ridiculous.
I know.
Do you know what all those buttons do?
All I know is my responsibility last time we were on the air 2 years ago was to show up and drink beer.
Right.
That was pretty much it.
Yeah.
That's all I had to do. Now I have buttons and stuff.
I think you can launch missiles from what they put in front of you.
And I just might.
But
there's buttons.
I was on
up here
still saying but. Remember the but?
But, mm-hmm. Yeah. I didn't notice it at the time, though.
I didn't either. Someone brought it up, and
he told me.
What?
I realized Opie said but because he said it. Yeah, he's like, I keep saying but. I'm like, oh.
All right, smartasses. This isn't Jocktober. That is funny.
Play more.
Yeah, let's hear more.
There's buttons and things that, and I'm supposed to do things.
Yeah.
I don't know. All of a sudden, they were talking about, like, we were talking about something we wanted to do later on in the show.
Uh-huh.
And they're like, oh, Anthony can trigger that. I'm like, no, I shan't be triggering anything. I'm not triggering things. Wait, I don't know.
That means we have something planned for later on?
Apparently.
Oh, all right.
I hope I don't have to trigger it.
And you got to love our old listeners. They're like, enough with the music. Start the show.
Yeah.
And now that they're paying for the Opie and Anthony show, they're going to get quite abusive, I think.
I know. Yeah.
But that wasn't our fault. See, we're working out all the bugs. I mean, we had this great intro to start off the show right at 6 a.m. You'd hear, you know, the graveyard music from The Good, The Bad, The Ugly. And all of a sudden, it went into another Metallica song. And
yeah, so we were 6 minutes late on that one.
And then there's another guy duct taping something together to my left. And
yeah,
half my buttons, I don't know what they do.
It's supposed to be how it goes anyway.
And then we got a camera crew in here and 15 people I've never seen in my life. All just staring at us. And we're supposed to be creative and funny right now.
Look, let's watch him and catch him on film being funny.
Right. This guy wants to shine a huge light on us up the studio. You think the light will be distracting? Oh, a little bit.
I think being here is distracting for us. After 2 years, getting up this early, I got to tell you, that was a little distracting for me.
What happened to us?
I was used to rolling home at this hour, you know? And just being Hank.
Ben.
And now we got to be responsible broadcasters.
Oh, the good old days. When we used to be able to be irresponsible broadcasting.
I know. This was a bad idea, man.
Wow. Back live. Guy, you hear Ben in the background.
Yeah. Is that all we have?
No, we got a whole bunch of stuff.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. Wow. Somebody was here on Pal Talk saying, wow, I never heard this. Not many people did because there weren't a lot of subscribers.
I remember at one point, before we went live, me and Oprah in Boston... And I forget why I was doing a gig. He came up, and we had just gotten on the fucking that platform, the pay platform.
Yes.
And it was slow going. I mean, to get people to get the word out, we had 11,000 listeners signed up at that point. And I remember that number. I was like, oh boy. But again, that was in the very, very before we even hit the air.
Weren't we on a pay platform during this?
Yeah.
So really, no one heard this fucking shit.
This was the beginning where it was like you had to pay an extra $2 a month.
$2 a month. You get Sirius or XM satellite radio. It was before they were together, and you had to pay an additional above your subscription $2 to hear us. What the fuck is that?
And we would scream about, get us on the fucking across the board so we can pick up listeners. Yeah. And eventually Eric Logan made that happen. What was it 6 months in maybe? I don't remember how, I hope you would remember. And they put us across the platform.
Yeah, they finally put us on.
And now it's weird. Like Sirius has to pay for Opie and Anthony and all XM listeners have to pay for Howard. But there's these extra things. But Sirius gets Howard for free and XM gets this show for free.
Yeah. I remember when you guys first started. I didn't have XM yet, but I was a fan.
Of course you were.
I bought I think the
talk
first,
about why you're a fan and how great we were.
I think I bought the first 2 weeks of shows illegally off a guy on eBay. Like, he sent me CDs for the first 2 weeks.
Nice. That was me, by the way. I needed some cash.
And then I started downloading the shows illegally before I could finally get a subscription. Oh,
finally, he admitted it.
Yeah.
Have him arrested.
I listened to that.
How about a microphone?
Yeah, exactly.
I listened to that.
Oh, jeez. He pulled it out.
And I realized, and this is so weird, that you guys have not grown in 8 years.
Not like, a bit.
If you would have turned that on without knowing what you guys were doing, people would have thought, oh, that's today's radio show.
It's our voice.
Yeah, there was a problem starting.
Yeah.
We didn't know if the mics were on. Yeah, that's about nothing has changed.
Nothing.
Do you want
You're
to hear the,
absolutely right.
the introduction of Jim Norton to the show?
Please.
We got to say hi to Jim Norton.
Yeah.
Hey, Jimmy. How are you?
I'd be better if I had room. I got two of the guys that took over the Russian middle school filming me from 3 feet away.
Oh, apparently that was, can you pause that? That was right after the, I believe the Chechenian Muslims slaughtered all the school children.
Yes. Jesus.
Yeah. Topical. Were they Muslims? I don't remember. I shouldn't say that.
I'm sure they were. And you should say it.
Two Chechenians just standing here with the camera in my face.
Would you like to take a seat, Jimmy?
No, I'm fine. I'd rather stand up.
You're
going to
stand up?
Yeah, I've been up since yesterday, man. If I sit down, I'm going to fall asleep.
Yeah, that's one person that's really going to have a hard time adjusting is Lil Jimmy, because he's a stand-up comic, of course, everyone knows, and he's got that nightlife thing, you know? He's got to do his club gigs, and they're very late.
Yeah.
So he's pretty much the guy that's going to be up. And then stay up through the show and sleep when he gets home.
This is the best part of this whole thing. When Ant and I were deciding, should we do afternoons or mornings?
Mm-hmm.
I got about 1,000 phone calls from Norton. You got to do afternoons.
Panic to Jim.
I'll never sleep. When am I going to do my spots? When am I going to F my whores?
Dude, that really is what it's about. The night before the big return of the show, I got stood up by some woman and I paid for a prostitute.
You
so
did?
Nothing has changed in 2 years.
And nothing has changed in eight.
No. I can't believe that's fucking 8 years ago.
I know. It really is. Yeah, it really is something.
12 years I've been going on fucking Opie and Anthony.
12.
Because it was 2 years ago.
Yeah.
2 years before that.
Jesus.
Holy
Tough Crowd was still on the air during that. We were in the final. Yeah. That was October. Tough Crowd went through November of 2004. That was in a weird bleed-over period where Tough Crowd and Opie and Anthony were on the air together.
I think listening back to this, too, I could hear, I think to take the edge off a little, I might have popped a Xanax.
Really?
Yeah, because I kind of hear, like, my tongue is, like, I'm a little slurry. I'm a little fucking slurry in this.
Were you nervous going in?
Yeah, I might have had a little anxiety.
That's so fun.
I fucking tic-tac the fucking Xanax, and I was like,
really?
Yeah.
Cut
yeah,
to me I might have been a little ago.
A wrench.
When was the last time you were nervous doing a show?
When I do, when I call in to the after show, I get very nervous.
Okay, I can
because
sense that
the bar is set so high.
Yeah.
That, no, it's not.
No, I. The good thing is, doing this for this long, you don't really get nervous anymore, which is great. It's even for TV, like Red Eye, doing Red Eye, you know, like that. And when we did the Rot Gut show, I used to get so nervous before we did a live gig with the band. And then it just becomes like, oh, I've done this before with crowds of people at appearances, so I never really got to get nervous anymore, which is good. I like that. I like that part.
Yeah. Speaking of nervous. Do you want to meet Eric?
Oh, my God. Is this
Oh, God,
yeah. This is great. 8 years ago today, we first got on satellite radio, and this is kind of cool.
Do you think we're going to hear a radio voice?
Well, you keep in mind that Eric had not been smashed. He had not been called fat. He had not been made fun of for a radio voice.
He was just Eric.
And he was like, holy shit. I'm here with Opie and Anthony.
His
and
dream
Jim
come
and
true.
He was Sex Bagel.
He was Sex Bagel.
And this was also when Opie was his true hero.
That's right.
Yep.
Yeah.
I can't believe it. I'm here. I
can't believe it.
Wait till my Scott Shannon sees me.
My big chance. I bet. And he's probably saying, like, I bet in, let's just say, I'm going to pick a number, 8 years from now, I am going to be a huge person in the radio industry. There he is, sitting behind the fucking...
Yeah, he is a huge person in the radio industry.
Yeah.
Looks like the Nagel kid really took off.
What happened to that Nagel kid? Where did he end up?
How'd he get so big and famous?
Well, that Nagel kid was really big and real big.
The creeper kid used to always capture my photos.
So you think this was like, okay, I've hit the pinnacle of producing. Yes. I made it to the Opie and Anthony show. Now it's straight to stardom.
To the top. And there he is.
All right, here,
I want to hear this.
Here's meeting Eric.
So Steve is an official member of the Opie and Anthony show now.
Yeah.
And then we brought a new guy aboard, Sex Bagel. He's in the other room.
Where is Vanilla Ice Hair? Can he come in for a couple seconds?
Ice. Yeah, he was first so insult.
The first E-Rock
first
insult.
First insult to E-Rock.
Oh, many, many to follow over the years, but that was the first one thrown out by Jimmy Norton.
What a trivia question. Who would have thought it was Vanilla Ice Hair?
Vanilla Ice Hair. That's a great. And Vanilla Ice Cream Belly.
Where is Vanilla Ice Hair? Can he come in for a couple seconds?
Yeah, he was so excited that we hired him for the show that he went out and dyed his hair.
Now, I was a little confused. I still am a little bit.
Oh, what?
About Eric. Because he's like 15 years old, but he's been in radio with like Marconi. He's worked with all of them. He's worked with 80 people in radio. Everyone that's in radio, he's worked with at some point. Yet he's only 15.
And he never shuts up.
Boo.
I do second that. He likes to talk. But that's okay. And Eric Sexbagel is aboard the Opie and Anthony show as well.
Yeah. He will be doing what? Taking your phone calls and whatnot?
And various other things that no one else wants to do.
He has Stinky's old job.
Yes, he does.
That's what it was. Taking the calls.
Very appreciative to have it.
E-Rock, what are you doing?
Very appreciative to have it.
Very appreciative. Oh, thank you. A little ass-lapping right there?
Very appreciative to have it.
Just happy to be here.
You think he feels that way today?
Wish he was saying that about a fucking brain tumor.
And no, he does not feel like that now.
Very appreciative to have it. Oh, thank you, thank you. He had his head bowed down.
Yeah.
It's like just fucking bowing. Oh, just happy to be here. Glad to have the opportunity. I want to thank everybody.
And how different was it with Opie saying, yeah, he does talk too much. Nah, but that's okay. It's Eric. He's on the show now.
Yeah.
Whereas now he would have been like, stop, shut your fucking
shut
mouth.
Shut up with your vagaries and rambling. any more clips?
I can't
get enough of these. This is great. What else are we going to delve into 8 years ago today?
This clip is called "If We Screw This Up, It's Over."
Yeah, well, that's true.
So it's the Opie and Anthony show. We've begun. We've begun the third stage of the Opie and Anthony show, and the final stage.
3.0. ONA 3.0.
This is, yeah.
Very internet.
ONA 3.0 and the last version of Opie and Anthony. When we screw up this time, it's over.
Yeah,
it's absolutely over.
Let us say that because we said when we started.
Oh, hold on a second. Hold on.
NEW.
Comments starting to come in. Best part of the show from 8 years ago? No Sam.
Just an eclipse here.
Why did I even have to read that?
It's just hurtful. I mean,
it's
I guess you have to get the list.
Yeah.
Are you going to cry like me?
Then go home and say, Mom, I cried on the show today.
Ugh. Faggot.
We said when we started at NEW in New York, we said, look, there's going to be a day where we screw up. And you will just not hear us anymore because you don't get to say goodbye on the radio. They just fire you, throw your ass out, and you're done. And that did happen. And all the websites started, you know, people save ONA, this, that, the other thing. Who do we call? Who do we write to? If we screw this one up, don't bother. No, make no phone calls. Don't start up any websites. Don't write any letters. Just say, well, that was fun while it lasted, and it'll be over.
It's called retirement.
Right, because we will totally have burnt every single bridge that there is.
Yeah, because if we blow
what
this...
What am I doing?
Wait, go back a little bit and hear that.
Yeah, listen to that when I said we burned every single bridge that there is. I sound like fucking... I sound like Spock trying to talk over his dentures.
Bridge that there is. Yeah, because we'll just be done.
There's a little bit of a radio voice. Not that bad, though.
This,
at the Ritz.
No, I think I was completely Xanaxed.
Oh,
out. I was like fucking.
You were
Xanaxed.
Fucking zooted.
Zooted. Yes, Chip. This was pre-Chip too. Pre-chip. Wow. Oh.
I've lost just every single bridge that there is. Yeah, and, because and we'll just be done.
If we blow this, like we said on Ungagged, mm-hmm. the only option open to us will be CB radio.
CB radio, right. Breaker, breaker. It's the O&A show.
And we do plan on screwing it up again, by the way.
Yeah, at some point. I don't doubt it.
That was before podcasting was an option.
Yeah. Yep, that's true. Yeah, yeah.
And when you guys almost, well, I wouldn't say you guys, but when you almost did get fired.
November.
Oh, my God.
Oh, man. I didn't even think. I meant, like, later on with the Homeless Charlie thing.
Oh, no, this was a month in.
And the listeners actually did write letters and make phone calls.
And they broke their units in the street. Yeah, yeah, and we had a voice back.
But it worked.
That was when Patrice was on. It's funny, I just saw John Gibson two nights ago. I did Red Eye with him.
That clip
of Patrice doing the Angry Pirate.
One
I was
of the
just
funniest
talking to,
fucking what, appearances on the news.
Just talking to John Gibson about that.
Wait, what did Patrice do?
When we were in trouble for Homeless Charlie, where Hugh Panera wanted to fucking fire us before the merger, Patrice went on Fox. It was just, you know, defending us to the stupid cunty feminist who he was talking to, and he made a fool out of her. It was one of the Patrice's best clips, and it was John Gibson's show. So I just did Red Eye with him coincidentally the other night. Wow, is that video Travis or for what?
Yeah, of Patrice.
Oh, it's not the. Was he there the first day?
No, I think this is the Angry Pirate.
Do we have any of the first day footage?
Yeah, where did
I have
that
no
go?
Clue.
Where is that footage?
I don't know where that is.
This is the Angry Pirate.
All right.
Stop supporting negative language in music and talk radio. And also, our favorite stand-up comic, Patrice O'Neill.
Oh, thank you, sir.
Patrice, are O&A next?
I hope not. I hope JV. I wish JV and Elvis didn't lose their job or Imus. It's funny. This is the thing. I don't know her, but I'm assuming that she has nothing to do with funny. So I'm going to speak as the expert on funny. Funny people should just be left to trying to be funny.
What if they're not funny?
Then you made a mistake. But how many unfunny rape jokes lead to rape? Like,
I don't know how many jokes about rape there are.
There's a lot. But your world is not funny. Your world is next on the big story. My world is people trying to be funny.
Well, I mean, you think it's okay to try to make jokes about rape?
I'm diabetic. I make fun of that. I'm a victim. I might lose a toe. But I'm trying to make fun of. I'm trying to make fun of anything I think I can make fun of.
Sonia?
You know, what's happening now is the marketplace.
Okay.
Is deciding what's appropriate or what's not appropriate. I think the nation is just tired. There's a new mood in the nation.
What nation?
The nation. You know what? We're tired of things that
is
are just
the nation is paper and you? I'm not the nation. I'm just speaking for me and funny. You're speaking for the nation or are you speaking for...
Yeah, you know why? Because I remember 6 years ago doing something against Anthony Opie because they were just so outrageous and their violent images they put out to women was just uncalled for. And now, I think people...
You think they were trying to be funny?
I think now people in this country
are trying to be funny.
You know what? I don't care if they're trying to be funny.
That's what I'm saying. Let me tell you something. Why are you in that business?
I've been to your show once, and it wasn't very funny being a woman.
It was hilarious.
When you talk about...
That's why she don't like me. I was in the paper with her, and the joke is hilarious. It's called The Angry Pirate.
Oh, no.
And the lady who wrote it in her outrage didn't even know what it meant. And anybody who read it laughed because they know what funny... You're not living in the context of funny. You're living
all
in the context of fire.
They have every right to be as funny as they want. They can go out and try to be as funny as they want, make as much money being as funny as they want. This is what's happening. There is a change in this country. People are realizing they have an opportunity to speak out, and advertisers are listening.
You're
radio
not talking,
stations
you're
are
not
listening.
Talking, you,
Sonia,
you're not talking to who I talk to.
And you're not going to get paid as much money anymore.
Sonia and Patrice,
that's
look
what
at this.
It is. The marketplace
more
is
CBS
speaking.
Radio firings. They've been on a tear lately.
All right.
Are they cleaning house, or is this the PC cops run amok?
You know what it is, John. You know what it is while you're reading that paper. It's the PC cops run amok.
Well, you think she's a PC cop?
Of course she is. She has an entire encyclopedia of her stance on it, but it's no passion involved. It's not a real. This is just what she has to say. We are outraged and fired. Name calling. I'm outraged. I am outraged.
You should be. You should be outraged.
I am a fool. Now, if I called you a fool,
you know what?
Who are these people
in this country?
Who are the people?
A new
how can you, Patrice? So here's what.
Decency.
Here's my question. How can you justify a bad joke, a joke that isn't funny? Oh, wait a minute. Wait.
Go ahead.
An attempt that isn't funny, doesn't get any laughs, and is about raping the first black woman to ever become the Secretary of State of the United States.
Throw that at me.
Well, why don't
is what I'm trying to fight for. The joke may or may... Funny jokes and unfunny jokes are come out of the same birth. That you don't know if anything is going to be funny. You should attempt
don't
to be
you,
able to make anything
don't you
funny.
You think a joke about rape is doomed to be not funny?
It's possible, but I've heard them.
You've heard a funny rape joke?
I say a couple. Watch my HBO special. I'm pretty good at it.
Patrice says that if you're having sex with a woman, doggy style, and if you hit her in the head just the right time.
No, it's ejaculate in her eye and kick her in the shin, and she walks around like, arg! It's the angry pirate. No, that's what she was trying to say.
A violent act of hitting her in the back of her head, her body.
It's called the donkey punch.
Which will then.
Why are you laughing? She's outraged. It's called the donkey punch. It's called humor that she has no clue what it is.
You have the same problem that Opie and Anthony does. You can't say just anything on the air.
You can say anything you want. It might not be funny. You might get in trouble for it, but you should be able to be attempting. And plus, when is a crazy bum going to get an opportunity to rape the president? If the president's wife, John? It was trying to be funny.
All right, Patrice, why aren't I hearing Al Sharpton complain about this thing involving Congress?
Because it wasn't involving young black women.
Well, it's involving a very prominent black woman.
Well, where was she during young black? Everybody has their agenda.
I was there.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. All right, excuse me.
Why am I not hearing from Sharpton?
Because it doesn't concern him. It's not concerning him. It's black. It's, you know, come on now. You know, Al Sharpton has his agenda, and it was perfect for Al. Young black women. And now she's representing just women in general. She's not representing the nappy hoe part. She's representing just the hoe. The nappy-headed part, she has nothing to do with. Just the hoe.
Sonia?
You know what? Women have been abused publicly in the media for too long, and people are tired of it. This has been a beautiful response of just the general public saying to advertisers, we're your consumers, we don't want to have to avoid everything in the street, we don't want to have to worry about what radio station we turn on, and there is some really derogatory, violent thing to deal with.
All your information, ma'am, is secondhand from someone making you aware that someone may have said something that you should be upset about. It's a shame. Your constituency, the people you represent aren't all victims in this matter.
Patrice O'Neill, thank you very much. Sonia Osorio, thanks to both of you. Appreciate it. Time for big politics.
That was, that's great, man.
He was so fucking brilliant.
He was so fucking good. God, was that funny. Just to so naturally get on a TV show like that and just be funny. And pertinent. That was great.
I wouldn't say poignant.
Or poignant.
We're clearing. Rich has moved over one because Anna's here, so we should just bring her right in, I guess, right?
Mm-mm. Yes, let's bring in right away. We'll talk about the debate and everything.
Plugging her book.
Mugged. Ann Coulter. Hi, Ann.
Hello.
How are you?
How are you?
Take
you
a
have that
seat.
Great book.
Yes.
Yes, mugged.
Hello, good to see you again.
How you doing?
You know Rich Voss?
Well, actually, I don't know if you know me, but I've seen you perform. But we haven't been on Red Eye together, have we?
No, but I saw you one night at the Cellar, and we introduced each other.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I know you.
Well, I know you, and I'm a big fan.
Right back at you.
Big fan.
And who's this?
Jimmy Norton. You two are pals. You guys know each other.
Smell very good.
Of course.
Yes.
It does smell very nice.
Yeah, they tried to get me on Red Eye the other night when you were on because they know I love you.
Thank you. Mm. Why didn't you do it?
I was already booked.
Oh, okay.
They asked me that day.
Yeah.
But I almost canceled everything I was doing, but I couldn't.
Yeah, no, you plug in a book. It's understandable. You got to do the shows to have you on.
I definitely want to get into the debate in a little bit, but initially, your book, Mugged, you were on The View. I saw that clip with Whoopi. Thank God for you, because it exposed what a lot of people do, especially people like Whoopi, a black celebrity. They hear race,
yeah.
And it's instantly a bad thing that they need to get defensive about.
Right.
Even the discussion of race is taboo these days.
No, that's right. And unlike the gals on The View, though I thought it was a great interview because I realized everything they're saying to me, you can make fun of them, but they believe everything the New York Times believes, yes. And that's why I wrote this book, so that people would stop believing lies. But if you've read my book, there are a lot of black heroes in the books, which I attack white liberals for hiding from us.
Right.
No,
yes.
They celebrate the cop killers and the gangster rappers. I celebrate the ones who testify against the cop killers.
Yeah.
And there's some pretty spectacular ones. That one at the beginning of the book with the ambush at the Farrakhan Mosque at the beginning of the John Lindsay administration is a spectacular story. It was written about in this book, Circle of Six. And then I summarize it and give some of the highlights. But it was just, they just wanted to kill cops. They call 911. Yeah. Cops run in. They get ambushed, locked in a stairwell. All these black Muslims running down the stairs shouting Allah Akbar. They start stomping and beating the cops. They're beaten to within an inch of their lives. One has his gun grabbed from him when they're just lying in the foyer, bloody and with a mob of Muslims stomping them, grabs his gun, shoots him point blank in the chest, and he later dies. And the Lindsay administration, you know, that fabulous administration that covers the whole thing up. Eventually, the cop killer is brought to justice because of one of his fellow black Muslims, who then instantly has to go into the witness protection program.
Sure. Yeah.
Why? That would make a spectacular movie. Why don't we have a movie about him? No, we have a movie about the cop killers.
Yeah, yeah. It's it really is amazing, the double standards that are out there as far as race is concerned and the hypocrisy that's out there. And when you were doing The View, it was pointed out how, especially with Whoopi, she didn't even know what she was supposed to be upset about.
Right.
That
right.
was the thing. I was listening to the clip and... And she's upset. She's tripping over her words because she's trying to run it through her head. I'm supposed to be mad at something.
Right.
Because it's Ann Coulter and she's talking about race.
It's talking about race. And you brought it up. It was brilliant. You said, no, I'm talking about white liberals here.
Right.
This, the point isn't black people. It's the white liberals what they have wrought.
Yeah.
On society.
Which is why they are completely ignoring this book. Other than The View, I wanted to kiss each one of them before I left because it's the only mainstream media attention I've gotten for this book. Even for my very first book, when nobody knew who I was a practicing lawyer, wrote High Crimes and Misdemeanors. I did Good Morning America and the Today Show. Or for subsequent books, at least they'll attack me without even inviting me on their shows.
Yeah.
This one, they will not mention. Even MSNBC, and that must take an incredible amount of self-control. Because I keep taunting Rachel Maddow and Chris Matthews for knowing no black people, which they do not.
Because it's about race, they will not touch anything about race unless it's from the point of view that they co-sign.
Well,
they won't touch it.
Just the fact that they hired Reverend Al over there, and if you how they can...
He looks good, though, since the... Jesus. I think he had the lap band.
Band.
With the little, his head is not shrunk at all.
He's
terrible.
He looked a little better with some meat on his bones.
Yeah, he really looks awful. Big dump thermometer.
He's throughout this book. He's the one black person who may not like this book, but I've forgotten how much stuff he was involved in.
Oh, my
Basically,
God.
Every issue of racial demagoguery, and there's Al Sharpton.
Friends. Yeah.
Yeah.
Front and center.
And do you guys remember, I'd forgotten about this, he was caught on an FBI surveillance tape, apparently trying to buy boatloads of cocaine, and the transcript looks pretty bad. His excuse was, I was scared, I was just going along, and apparently the FBI, they released a statement saying that he became an informant for them, but that tape was right about the time of Tawana Brawley, and it remained secret for 18 years.
Oh, amazing.
Didn't HBO run that first?
Yeah, Brian Gumbel.
Yeah.
Amazing. And MSNBC has hired him on and lets him spout his nonsense over there. And they rip people apart for the smallest things if they don't agree with the MSNBC point of view. Yet they never call him out on his absolute lies.
Right.
The fact that he, during the Tawana Brawley case, people's lives were ruined because of him.
Yes, and one of my favorite moments for Al Sharpton was after the shooting of Gabby Giffords in Arizona. Weirdly, Al Sharpton became the go-to guy about how angry rhetoric can lead to violence. Oh, well, you certainly know. There was Freddie's.
Yes.
was Howard Beach.
Crown Heights. It was great.
And he showed up at the trial of the Sandra Park rapists, whom, by the way, were guilty. Yeah. But that I wrote about in my last book, Demonic. 100% guilty. I don't care what the DA office puts out. And he showed up the day to rally. There were angry black protesters outside that.
Duke LaCrosse.
The Sandra Park rape. Remember that one? It was like a decade ago.
The wilding. That's where we heard the term wilding.
Right. He showed up with Tawana Brawley to say, "I want to see how the justice system works when the victim is a white woman." Wait a second, but your client wasn't a victim.
It was a lie. Yeah, why are you parading it around like it really happened? Yeah. It's an absolute lie.
And the crowd ran after the victim herself, who lost 80% of her blood and nearly died in the Central Park rape. The angry black crowd ran after her, calling her a slut.
Great.
They will not. It's amazing how white. This is what drives me crazy. White people are never comfortable calling black people out when they behave racist. They're only and again, I've always thought that's the fucking. The liberals that do that, that's the comfort of the ruling class, to only scold each other. This parental attitude of we treat each other with a certain expectation of behavior, but of course you people can behave how you want, because that's what you do.
Yes. Though I would add a footnote to that. They're not really calling each other out. when they say America is racist, they don't mean they're racist.
No,
they mean you're racist.
Yes. You're racist, right. But, yes.
But a lot of this isn't done by light-skinned blacks.
What? Oh, Rich.
Oh, Rich. It was actually a valid point.
Rich is trying to. Yeah. How do you think? I'm amazed, and I love the fact that you usually emerge from controversy that would bury people pretty unscathed.
Do you mean me?
No, not you, Jimmy Norton. The lovely Ann Coulter. And
no,
her
you
book,
emerge
Monk.
Dancing a jig and high fiving, which I am only doing in my heart.
When did you get over that hurdle of you don't have to worry that your livelihood is going to be taken away because of something you say or write?
That's actually a great point.
It is.
That is what I write about, how for years white people were walking on eggshells. They could have their careers destroyed.
Totally.
And that makes it difficult. I think during that time, I say it all changed with the OJ verdict when white America just said, screw it. White guilt bank is shut down. We had a dozen years of paradise and then Obama brings it all back. That's the arc of this book. But it would be very hard to be friends or friendly or just have a normal relationship with a black person when you're terrified that if you use the word the, like Donald Trump did when he said, I have a great relationship with the blacks, people will hysterically accuse him of racism.
Exactly, yes.
Yeah.
It's amazing how people have to circumnavigate their vocabulary around people, or else you can lose your job.
You have to be, like, whenever I'm around one of my black friends, I'll always be very careful. If I'm talking about another black guy, I'll say, well, he was up, and I'll say, well, he was a you-know-what. And that will allow them to know.
No, I ran into David Limbaugh in the Hannity studio the other night, and we were talking about all the phrases that we would totally use if Obama were white.
Right.
But you catch yourself like, you know, he's guilty of this in spades. Oh, gotta cut that line.
We all know what it means. That's the thing, too. You could be so innocent with what you're talking about. And then you watch some of the liberal media, and you go, really? People will sit there and literally say, they'll play a clip and go, well, you know, that's a code word.
Yeah.
That's a signal. This is means. What he meant was.
Right.
What?
No, and meanwhile, look at the way they talk about Clarence Thomas, Condoleezza Rice, Mia Love.
Oh, you mean Uncle Toms and.
Well, and the N-word. They come right out with that and just ugly racial stereotypes. I think both Herman Cain and Clarence Thomas were outrageously falsely accused of the most vile stereotype about black men as sexual predators. senators. I mean, it's like liberals just go to the NAACP for a warrant. Can we attack this black person? Yeah, sure, that's fine.
Let her
go
rip,
right
yeah.
ahead. Yeah, and it's as if they spend so much time patronizing non-entities like Barack Obama, Nobel Peace Prize, the moment he takes office.
Oh, my yeah. God.
That they've been suppressing. They're just dying to call some black person the N-word. And then Clarence Thomas comes along. Let her rip.
Yeah, yeah. Yep. God, it really is amazing. Where do you see this going? Where do you see, because I think there's a pretty huge racial divide in
Recently
this country.
It's come back.
Yes, it has. Absolutely. I've never seen the country this divided since, you know, the fire hoses and German shepherds were out and about. Where do you see this going, though? What's the end
game? Well, I hope we'll get past it, and I especially hope we'll get past it in the 2012 election. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is like Dinkins' second run against Giuliani. Oh, and when he ran the first time, Ken Allett, I quote him in my book, wrote an article in the Daily News saying, even if Giuliani would make a better mayor, you have to vote for Dinkins because he'll be the first African-American mayor. And boy, a lot of white people thought that with 2008 election. More white people voted for Obama than voted for any Democrat for president in like 40 years.
Yeah, yeah.
So there was a lot of white guilt operating there. and hopefully they'll get over it in time for November 6th, considering how he's wrecked the country. And, you know, reflect back on what would have happened if we had had another 4 years of Dinkins rather than Giuliani.
Right. Yes, exactly.
Romney did very well last night. I didn't watch the debate.
Yeah.
I was out at an event. You know, invited guests, send the car for me. It's not important. But everyone said the clips I've seen, Romney did very, very well, yeah. And he seemed much better than I thought he would do.
Unbelievable.
He was a better debater than I thought he was.
You know what happened here? Also, the liberal media backfired. What they've been doing to Romney, how they presented Romney, always just editing video to make him look stupid.
Yes.
Calling him stupid, silly.
Arrogant, elitist. He does not come across that way at all when you really see him.
And when he got up there last night and sounded intelligent and had ideas and was able to respond to anything thrown at him without stammering,
right.
with facts,
yes.
with common sense, you looked and went, this is the blithering fool that the press was putting in front of us?
Yes.
He's great.
Why do you think Obama was, like, looking down? Like, because he's a smart guy. He's not a good debater. He's not a dummy.
Is he, though?
Yeah, he's a bright guy. He is a bright guy.
He's not as smart as Romney.
Maybe not.
Yeah. Smarter than McCain.
But he's smart enough to have had more of an involved debate. But just even watching the body language, it was weird to see him,
I think he knew about halfway through he was having his ass handed.
He was alpha-maled. He was alpha-maled. First of all, he was out of his league as far as, especially talking about domestic issues and the economy. Anytime Romney brought up a fact about the economy, what could Obama do but put his head down?
Yeah.
He's embarrassed by what he's done to this country in 4 years. So he had no other choice but to put his head down. Romney had all of his facts out there, and I saw a moment last night that was absolutely one of those, well, there you go again moments. And it was when Obama brought up the fact of getting a tax credit for sending jobs overseas. And Romney sat there and said, look, I've been in this for 25 years, a business. And he goes, and I don't know what you're talking about.
Yes, yes.
That was a 1-2 beautiful job he did on that one. And Obama just, again, put his head down and kind of shook his head.
It's the first time he's been challenged.
Exactly.
In his entire life, every place he's gone since he went to kindergarten.
Yes.
Oh, look, we have this nice young black child.
Right.
Let's give him all A's and give him a Nobel Peace Prize and make him president of that. I mean, I don't think he's dumb. Like I say, he's between McCain and Romney. But you don't walk in from Occidental to Columbia and then Columbia. By his own account in his autobiographies, all he was doing was smoking pot. He goes on Letterman, and, you know, he's okay. He's no Jim Norton. And, oh, the audience, yay!
It really is amazing, the coddling and the adulation, the hero worship that he's gotten.
I think
you're right as far as him winning the election. A lot had to do with the first black, half black, but black president. it brought out voters that normally wouldn't come out. It rallied people around this hope and change and the first black guy. It was like a whole very abstract, artsy kind of a thing.
Yes.
When we need a numbers guy.
I wanted to see a black president. You're right. I wanted to see a black president. I felt it was a huge thing for the country. I wanted him to win. And I like John McCain, too. I really do. I like both of those guys. But for that reason. But you know what? The first time I saw Obama, I went, wow, he's not. Was the acceptance speech. I thought McCain's speech. Oh, my God. Would you give concession speech. Yeah. Was better than Obama's acceptance speech. I thought it was more.
Wow.
That was the first time I almost liked McCain.
You don't like McCain? Yeah. I like him, but I thought his concession speech.
It was a good speech.
Well, yeah. Things.
I think Netanyahu challenged him in the White House that day when he said, "I'm not giving up my borders," because he was in shock because no one's ever talked to him that way.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. And during the elections, the kids were voting. We're voting out of emotions, not out of intellect.
Well, exactly.
It was pure emotions. Because you would say on stage to somebody, who are you voting for? Obama. Why? He's not Bush. Well, Bush isn't re-running. I'm not Bush. Okay? They had no clue.
You would think Obama was running against Bush with how they just... Yeah.
Last night, that was an hilarious exchange last night when Obama starts citing the economic record of Bill Clinton.
Of Bill Clinton, yes.
What about the last 4 years? And by the way, Clinton's record sucked the first 2 years. That's why Republicans took Congress for the first time in four decades.
Yes, yes.
And then, Clinton just signed whatever Newt Gingrich's Republicans sent up to him. That's when the economy picked up. Okay, fine. Clinton is going to lyingly claim credit for it. But wow, that's weird having an incumbent president. I mean, why not start talking about FDR?
Yeah. But you know why? Again, he can't talk about his own record.
Yeah.
I mean, it's abominable. Unemployment?
Yes.
And the fact that if I see one more of these idiots on the news talking about how he's creating jobs.
I know.
Does anyone believe this?
Oh, yeah. And you remind me of one other thing I loved about the debate. For every question, it could be about the economy, about jobs, about the purpose of government. Obama's answer was, we need more teachers.
Yes, he kept talking about the teachers. Education, the teachers. We need more teachers. What?
Because they're government workers. They're unionized. They have fantastic pensions. I mean, it's like a triple whammy. They're usually educators. They don't see the inside of a classroom. They're the superintendents and so on.
Right.
So it's a job we don't want done. We're paying too much for it. It's paid for by the taxpayer. No job at all is better than hiring a new government worker.
Yeah, yeah. I also love when after the debate how they were saying, Romney wasn't very clear. He wasn't giving details. 2 minutes you get. And I think he gave a lot of detail about what his vision is and how he's going to achieve a lot of this in the limited time in a debate. People expect him to go on for 5 hours and discuss what his plans are.
And he had a really good answer for that. He said, look, I have some ideas on specifics, but I'm giving you general points because I'm not going to go in and say my way or the highway. I did this with an 87% Democratic legislature in Massachusetts.
Yep.
They come up with ideas. I come up with ideas. Overall, I want to lower the tax rate and eliminate loopholes.
Yeah.
They said
he
seemed more moderate, like a little bit more, which I think is a mistake for Romney to just kind of try to talk to the arch conservatives. He's got their vote. I don't care what he says. None of them are voting for Obama. Yeah. It's that small group that he has to get. And he's a more moderate. I mean, if he ran Massachusetts, he's not a quote unquote Bush conservative.
Right.
And he has to kind of make that clear. So, because I wouldn't vote for a religious conservative. I don't want it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I
like when they're talking about exposing his lies about the taxes and how he's cutting the taxes for the wealthy when he never was even saying that. It's let's not raise them. A great point he brought up is you get the revenue not by raising taxes on the people that are working, but by putting more people to work, you're able to tax them. And you'll get more revenue and more people will be working. It's better than, if you get two people that are being taxed $10 each, It's better than the one guy having to pay $20.
Right.
So you spread out that burden.
And that's how Reagan did
people.
It. He cut taxes 25% each year. Each year, the Treasury got more money.
More money because more people were working.
Yeah, unfortunately, Tip O'Neill and the Democrats spent $2 for every additional dollar that was brought in under Reagan, and that's what created the deficit. But there is this lie that when Reagan was president, he cut taxes, the deficit went up. No. Revenue to the Treasury increased each year Reagan was in office, and each year the tax cuts increased.
I got a question. Do you think Obama is pro-Israel? Because as a Jew, I don't understand.
Really?
How,
I never would have guessed.
I know. Yeah. How so many Jews
I know
love him. And I mean, last night my sister is so liberal until a black guy moved next door, and she flew.
Jesus.
She flew, okay? And I text her last night. I go, your guy's getting killed. No response. I was talking to somebody. I go, your guy's getting killed. No, Jews. No response. And how much of a self-hating Jew are you that you can't... Listen, if you don't even vote then.
Right.
You know what I mean?
I think it might... I mean, we never get more than, what, the maximum is 39%. Of the Jews will vote Republican. I think that's the highest. What Reagan got in 1980, I think that was it. And, you know, that's the most we can shoot for. But, I mean, at least the Jewish vote is a useful example for the black vote, because people keep saying if Democrats are so bad for the blacks, why do they vote 90% for the Democrats? Well, okay, explain the Jews. Explain that.
But it's not only the small vote the Jews have, it's the money they're putting behind.
Oh, absolutely.
It's the money they're throwing into this campaign.
And every place I go, I mean, even to my Jewish doctor, he doesn't even want to talk about, you know, my exams. He just wants to say, what is with the Jews voting for Obama?
Yeah.
For the ones paying attention, it drives them crazy.
And meanwhile, he's snapping out a rubber glove. You're like, can we discuss this later? This is a horrible time to talk about this.
Yes, it's like you were in the room, Jim.
Yeah, believe me, I've gotten it even when I didn't need exams. Put the glove on, Doc, please.
His blatant disregard for Israel.
It's shocking. Dissing Netanyahu. And do you know...
I would do the View Over meeting with him. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
Did you see it? We had Dinesh D'Souza, I think is how you say his name, who did the Obama documentary. He made some interesting points about, he thinks, Obama's anti-colonialism, which I never connected, but the way he would like support Libya and support in Egypt, but not... do anything about the Iranian revolution or anything about Syria. Like, he was kind of selective in the ones that he helped. Made some great points.
The thing that really stood out with me when I saw 2016 was the fact that you have to be influenced by people that raised you, that were so adamant about their political point of view and putting it on a young Obama. How are you not influenced by the communists and socialists that he was surrounded by growing up?
You might rebel against it, but he hasn't.
yeah. It really is just... And the fact that it was pointed out that no one really knows this guy. We didn't know him like we've known past presidents. You know,
no, that's specifically why they chose a 14-year-old. Because usually Democrats get nailed on the things they voted on in the past. They get nailed on their records. Hillary was for health care. John Kerry for voting for the Iraq War before voting against it. So Democrats finally figured out, we just have to get to quote Joe Biden, a clean and articulate 14-year-old.
Do you like Joe Biden? I have mixed feelings. There's something about him
he's
genuinely
very likable.
Like,
you're right.
Yes.
No, that's very smart of you. I think people are overestimating how great how Ryan's going to mop the floor with Biden. He is sly, and he's been in this business for a while, and he has that Irish charm.
And he shoots, I hate to say he shoots from the hip, but there's times, but the thing that will kill Biden will also be very successful is when he goes off book, you're kind of putting your head under the table, but then he'll say something that's really beautiful, and you're like, wow, that was a great
it
moment.
It really is frightening to watch him when he deviates. Yeah. You're like, oh,
it's
no.
Like, it's like watching your child do a monologue in a play. You're like, oh, my God. but I find him. I do think that they're underestimating how he is, because he's been in a lot of these. Maybe.
Yeah,
it's not his first day.
Yeah, but then it does have the capability of saying stuff like he said the other day with the middle class. And I do like how Romney used Biden's language as far as the middle class was being buried. He goes, the past 4 years, they've been buried. It's like Biden said that. He said, the middle class, over the past 4 years, they've been buried. It's like, you've had you guys in there? What are you talking about?
Yeah.
What a great Joe Biden faux pas.
Oh, yes.
He's had quite a few of those.
Yes.
Very funny.
Yeah, but that's there's something about that the people thought, because Bush had those, too. That Bush would just say things what?
Yeah,
but there was
something charming about
that.
Correct.
Because it's relatable. Like, you can't relate to a guy. Like, Romney is harder to relate to because he seems like every guy that's ever fucked you at work. Like, that's what he reminds you of.
You didn't watch the debate last night.
No, I don't mean last night. I mean before that.
But that's because it's what they're telling us about him. They've been telling us he's an elitist and out of touch, and he's so stiff. You have to watch these debates because I mean, I noticed this during the primaries. I was a long and early time Romney supporter, and my friends who opposed him would always say, every time they actually watched him give a speech, that's the best speech he's ever given. If he had been talking like this from the beginning, I would have said, and I'd say he has been talking like this from the beginning.
It's being presented though with such a biased point of view from the media. What I saw last night though also in Romney was a guy that was very on point. He wasn't rambling. Obama couldn't speak.
No,
it was amazing. Amazing.
Yeah.
And Romney had everything. And they were criticizing a lot of people on MSNBC, criticizing Jim Lehrer as far as...
Yes, blame the moderator.
Blaming the moderator. The thing is, Romney had balls and backbone. If he wanted to make a point, he steamrolled and made that point.
And Obama got 4 more minutes anyway, right?
Wound up getting 4 more minutes. Obama would go off on tangents. They'd be talking taxes, and then he's off on education and unemployment. Yeah. And Romney knew each point. He goes, all right, I'll address that. He goes, but then I want to get the other two issues that he discussed. He knew exactly what had been discussed and what he wanted to say about it. He was very, very, he came off as just very smart. And,
and competent. Please put this man in the Oval Office.
He came off as very competent. Somebody that could speak. That could multitask. That I was very surprised. Very surprised.
But the difference is, though, we did find out about Obama's grandmother. So we did get to learn about that.
I love those little stories that come out.
Yeah, it's interesting. That was the only story where he actually named who the person was, because Obama kept imitating what Romney was doing. Romney would, as you were saying, he'd give, okay, I have a 4-point answer. This is what we need to do. Cut taxes, restore energy, blah, blah, blah. And about halfway through, Obama started trying to do the 3 points, 4 points, but he'd forget what point he was on.
God.
And he'd just ramble endlessly. And Romney also, without overdoing it, I think very well used. I just met someone who, a small businessman, runs an electronics company, 4 employees. And then he went through, that was amazing, he went through the taxes this guy has to pay. There were like 7 different taxes.
Rattled them all off.
And said, at this point, he's already paying 50% in taxes, and Obama wants to raise the 35% tax rate to 40%. It was a devastating point, but it was a specific person he had met, a specific job.
Yes.
Toward the end, Obama tried to do the same thing, but all he could say was, well, 4 years ago when I was on the campaign trail, I ran into people too. What?
Yes, he meant driving.
You know what? I think the whole problem, and it is, because people, you know, farmers and steel workers, they know what they want. People know it's kids that can vote that are between, you know, 18 or whatever, and you know what I mean, and 27 or 25 that really have no clue. They're dumb.
Yes.
And so they're voting.
Got to raise the voting age.
I'm telling you.
It's really crazy, because Nixon lowered it, and the argument was, well, you can drink when you're 18. You can be drafted to go to war if you're 18. Okay, we no longer have a draft. You can't drink till you're 21. You don't even have to pay for your own health insurance until you're 25. Raise the voting age. And I must say, that's one thing that would really make me happy. If Romney could promise to restore the economy, get people working again, but keep the unemployment rate for young people through the roof, because I want them punished.
Yes, you might know this statistic.
Sure.
Throughout the country, and I don't know, would you think there's more liberal colleges than conservative colleges? Right?
Okay. Right?
He asks these questions like he's really
asking them. 98 to 2. No, but you know, but these professors
are brainwashing their students.
Of course, yes.
Okay, and these are the kids that are voting. They have no clue.
Right.
All they are doing is listening to the agenda of their professors. and these are typical, I mean, these are good questions, okay? And this is coming from a comic, not a politician. All right,
no,
certainly
you're
not a college student.
Right. All right? That's why Young Americans Foundation, people donate to them so they can subsidize my college speeches, because I will be the only conservative most of these college kids will hear in 4 years.
And they're more outraged by you being there than by the most horrible dictator.
I spoke at... at Syracuse, this was some years ago, and I've heard this a lot, but this I just particularly like this experience. And this kid keeps telling me, well, at the Green Party meetings, they say this, and they say this, and, you know, and the Democrats, the young college Democrats. And I said, what, are you a mole going to all these meetings? And he said, no, I used to be in the college Greens. And I said, well, what happened? And he said, I saw you give a speech here after 9/11, and you're the only one who made any sense. So he just left and signed up for the Republicans.
What do you think of Ron Paul?
Well, I like him, but he's a little crotchety. I like the Rand Paul version, you know, the basic libertarian ideas without the craziness.
Yeah, he does come off a little nutty.
He does, and some of his stuff is probably not too practical, but I just like the fact that he seems to, it's like we're kind of pegged with this choice, like, you're either gonna, like, I agree with Obama on gay marriage and a lot of issues that the conservatives don't agree on. But I don't want to pay any more taxes. You know, why I want Romney.
I stand with the blacks on gay marriage.
Yeah, and I'm telling you, I think Biden hurt him by forcing him to force Obama's hand on gay marriage.
Yeah.
That's going to hurt him.
Yes.
That was a blunder by fucking Biden forcing his hand on gay marriage.
If it was forced, I'm always suspicious of those things.
I don't think before the election Obama wanted to give 100% answer because he got the gay vote.
He don't
want
to give 100% of anything.
But he only stands to lose people who are against it.
Right.
Anybody who's for gay marriage is not voting for conservatives on that issue.
Probably right, though I know a lot of conservative gays, and until I've talked them out of gay marriage, most of them support it.
Yeah, but I think I want to see them be able to get married. I mean, you know, just in case.
Oh, they don't want to get married, Jim. I'll give you a little inside scoop on the gays.
Well, just in case.
You don't have to.
They have this fantastic excuse their whole lives. Oh, I'd love to marry you.
Yeah.
Well, you know, my parents are asking. You know I would, if only it were. They don't want marriage.
They want the benefits.
Well, you can get all the benefits. Through contract law. You can write a will. This idea that you can't leave things to your loved ones. There are crazy old ladies that leave their entire estates to their cats.
I know.
Gay guys can't figure out how to leave their... They're, you know...
Cock rings.
Oh, rich.
Oh, rich.
I was going to say they're electric spice racks to one another. Come on, they can too.
I like the fact that you were saying raise the voting age, but it sounds to me like you're trying to suppress voters. See, that whole thing with the voter identification and the suppression of voting, they're making it sound like they're not allowing people to vote.
Oh, yes.
I think with something as important as voting, maybe an ID isn't too much to ask.
No, and it's a perfect example of a phenomenon I describe in my book of liberals pretending to care about black people for 5 minutes and then dumping them for the issues they really cared. Civil rights for abortion on demand and Jim Norton's gay marriage. And,
it's not gay if I do it. It's only being open-minded.
And one of their favorite things is voter fraud. I mean, Democrats are famous for stealing elections, and they are willing to make the argument, black people are too stupid to get photo IDs
in order to
promote a cause they care about that has nothing to do with blacks.
So they're saying that when you're trying to suppress people's votes by saying that they have an ID, that you're really taking away from just the minority voters, black voters, Hispanic voters, because white people are able to get IDs because they
are responsible.
Responsibility,
right.
They got, and black people aren't.
Right.
In essence, that's what's being said here.
Slander black people so we can keep engaging in vote fraud.
Right. Because that's the, it's like, how do people fly or get on planes ever if they don't have an ID?
Yeah,
you have to have an ID of some
you
sort.
You need an ID, sorry.
To get into this building.
It's not a
problem. How many times did I have to pull out my ID to get in here?
For this dumbass show? But yet you can just vote as many times as you want, apparently. It really is amazing that that's even an issue.
Voter ID laws were pushed in, one of the first states to adopt them was Rhode Island, which, like Massachusetts, has an 85% Democratic legislature. Mm. And in both chambers, it was pushed by black Democrats who had experienced vote fraud themselves.
Amazing. It's
such a crock that this is
really
anti-black
is.
People.
And the fact that you people jump on it and call people racists that want this, it should just be that's the way it's got to be this way. We got to know that people aren't voting multiple times. That you have the legal ability to vote.
I mean,
when it comes to race, though, it seems like even conservatives back off on it. I mean, you wrote a book about it, but I mean, I'm talking about the political.
Yeah,
they're afraid of it too. Like even on Fox, they address it a little better than MSNBC does. But every white person is afraid to talk about race because the penalty for saying the wrong thing,
oh boy,
is devastating for everybody.
Yes.
And death.
Like they backed off Fox, and I love Fox, but they backed off on Jesse Jackson when they caught him in that microphone. Whispers talking down niggers when he said that about Obama.
Right.
That would have destroyed the career of any white person.
Exactly.
And they played it. But they didn't harp on it, and they didn't kill him for it, which they should have.
He was pretty much killed by Bill O'Reilly already, I think.
I just think that was something.
And I think that was that's part of the great thing that happened after the O.J. verdict. Jesse Jackson really faded from public view after that, and I don't think Bill O'Reilly would have relentlessly bird-dogged Jesse Jackson, except that all the white or racial bullying was falling on deaf ears after white people watched blacks across America cheer the O.J. verdict. That really changed the world for the better for at least a dozen years.
Yeah, but the racial, I was very disappointed that they didn't hit Jackson harder for that. Mm. I was, especially when Sharpton came out and said, well, that's not the Jesse Jackson I know. And they just didn't kill him the way MSNBC would have killed a white guy if he had slipped and said that under the microphone.
I think the whole thing, you asked me before, and I think the answer is it will probably change, I hope in time for November 6th. But I think with our generation, because which I define as the Brady Bunch generation, anyone who grew up watching the Brady Bunch, our entire lives, there was no Jim Crow. There were no separate water fountains. The only thing that happened, the only difference between the races is you got an advantage if you were black. You got into Harvard when you should have been going to Colgate. Doors open for you. You get a Nobel Peace Prize.
Yeah.
What I learned from the Brady Bunch is no matter how happy a family looks, you never know what the dad is doing behind closed doors.
I mean, the whole racism thing, it's like talking about the Teapot Dome scandal to people in our generation. And any Republicans who are uncomfortable with race relations really should read my book, because Republicans have nothing to be guilty about.
No.
Republicans have been magnificent on race relations, despite liberals rewriting the history to switch the parties.
Well, when you bring that up, and Whoopi had issue with that also, as did some of the other ladies there on The View, when you bring that up, they chastise you for delving back into ancient history.
Right, but they brought it up.
They bring up ancient history all the time when you talk about Jim Crow and the reasons that
all
we
Democrats
have these
doing
problems in minority communities. But, yeah, if it suits them, it's fine. If it suits you, you're a racist.
They were
and an
all
asshole.
Liberal Democrats. They've rewritten the history to call them conservative Democrats, other than Strom Thurmond, the only one of, like, 18. All of them were liberal Democrats. All of them were friends or the father of Bill Clinton and Al Gore. They were liberal on all the issues of the day. They hated Joe McCarthy. Bob Byrd had a 100% rating from NARAL. These were not conservative Democrats. They were liberals through and through, and it's just a lie to say otherwise.
Yeah. God damn, amazing. Mugged? Are you doing any signings or anything?
Well, your listeners probably won't. Well, maybe they will. I'm doing one in Washington, D.C. tomorrow, a happy hour.
Ooh.
Yeah, we're on in D.C. We're on everywhere. So,
oh, excellent.
Yeah, we're on everywhere in the U.S. and
it's
Canada.
It's Americans for Tax Reform. And I think the only price for admission is the cost of a book, and then they'll have food and cocktails, and it's around 4 o'clock at Americans for Tax Reform, and then Pomona, California next Sunday.
Let me tell you something. I had the pleasure a couple of times with going out with Anne and Andrew, when Andrew, of course, was such a blast to hang out with. And I got to tell you, Anne is fun to go out drinking with.
I know. We have to do that again.
It was a blast.
I never would have thought you had actually the hat with the with the two the bottles in the funnel. But I was very shocked to see that. But yeah, it's funny, people who meet you are always surprised, because they're always they don't think you're going to be as nice as you are, or have the, like, you know, the Comedy Cellar. You know, it's like, yeah, you know, you people would expect you to walk out.
Oh, it's the Ice Queen. Wow, look at
yeah, but yeah. It's this really weird misconception, and it's like the dirtier the act, the happier she is. It's like, but
that's why I love you, Jim.
Thank you. Yes, but it's amazing how people would never expect that. People are always surprised when you come to the Cellar, and they are kind of hesitant to say hello, and you're friendly to everybody and nice and engaging, and people are like, oh, I never expected that. Yeah.
It's just like Romney.
Yeah.
Yeah. You
know. It really is. They create a false image, and the reality is completely at odds with that.
But watching Whoopi, this was great too, because, and again, I like Whoopi Goldberg. I really do. I've always liked her as a stand-up, mm-hmm. but she didn't even know why she was mad.
Yes.
Yeah.
You don't know what it's like to be black. Like, she wasn't debating point by
neither
point.
No.
Like Rich said, it was just this emotion. It was just this,
oh, and
I'm supposed to say this because Anne is white.
Yes. Yes.
One you're going to like even more than that, because Whoopi Goldberg looks like Milton Friedman compared to my interview on The View with Joy Behar this week. You can find it online, because she put me on with a retarded black guy. And
was he real?
No. Yeah.
Well, now you're on with
and
a retarded white guy. Did you meet Rich?
And he just kept calling me names. So I started calling him a child molester and asking about his gay porn collection.
Oh, man.
And at the end, it was just, we hadn't even talked about anything Jewish, gay. We really hadn't talked about anything, since he just kept calling me a liar and a racist. In the end, he throws in homophobic and anti-Semitic.
Oh. All right.
It's fantastic. It's the best TV.
I gotta see that, yeah.
Who was the guy? What did he do? Like, what was his thing?
I suspect got a lot of advantages for being black, because otherwise...
I listened to your debate with Bill Maher online, and you were killing him, and then he would go right to the joke, the audience would go, yo... But on the issues, you were killing him.
Well, I think I told him at one point, we did a few of them, because I do think he's very funny, but, you know, he brags about not reading. And I told him during those series of debates, you could be so much funnier if you knew stuff.
Oh, wow.
No, really. He's really funny.
I heard he's really packing.
Yeah, he has a big penis.
I heard it.
I've heard that.
I heard
it
was a monster.
Yeah.
That's why why he's so confident.
How did we just segue into that?
Yeah, right
because you. Because you were saying the things that you value, and we were talking about the things that we respect.
we're
small men.
I'll ask him. I'm doing his show next Friday.
Oh, there you go.
I like Barr, too, though. A lot of people hate him, but he is a funny guy.
Yeah.
People forget that he's a funny stand-up. He's not an unfunny comic at all.
No. You know who isn't funny but has that whole ideology? Michael Moore. I get infuriated reading some of his tweets, and he couldn't even get to the point about Romney really showing something of himself last night. He had to just keep digging at him. He said,
I didn't pay attention to any of his tweets. I don't follow him or anything, but I thought somebody said that even he admitted.
Yes. Even he did. He did. Well, you couldn't not admit it, but he put it more on the fact that Obama was too laid back and wasn't paying attention.
Oh yeah, that old cliche.
Like, yeah, they're not giving Romney as much credit as he's due on this one, as much as they are going, hey, what happened to the Messiah? You know,
right.
He's
yeah.
supposed to be this great guy who would crush Romney. What do you think of the next two debates? You think you're going to see?
Well, I think the town hall debates are the stupidest debates we ever have. Yeah, it is. You talk about some of your audiences and the college kids. Yeah. It is complete morons asking questions. It's going to be 100% about contraception, gay marriage, global warming. I promise you,
what?
I would make a bet we will get a global warming
question.
When are
we going to talk about the whole Libya thing, the whole cover up there, you know,
the whole Libya thing.
It will probably be.
I know what you mean, Rich.
No, that That is a coherent question. What about the whole Libya thing? I could answer that as a presidential candidate.
It has nothing to do with a video that played 3 months ago.
Yeah.
And why is this administration covering this up on September 11th when...
A town hall debate. No, hopefully we'll get that at one of the moderated debates.
Yeah.
When Bush was running against the first Bush against Clinton, one of the town hall debate questions was, how does the deficit personally affect you? No, how do you feel about the deficit? I think it was. What is that? How do I feel about the moon?
What is that?
And he said, I'm not sure what you mean. Hmm. And that was when Clinton launched his "I feel your pain" line. It's perfect for smarmy jerks. The town hall debate. Yeah.
I thought Clinton made a good point, though. I think he makes a lot more sense now that he has no pressure on him about Islam. And he said something about you can't react every time you're insulted, and nobody says that. It's like nobody is going after the violent aspect of Islam and calling it what it is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everyone always has to give the asterisk of, well, and we know it's not all Muslims.
We know that. Just the extremists.
Enough already with fucking clarifying. The only reason people do that is because they're afraid.
Yes.
If they don't clarify, what are you afraid that the quote unquote good ones will come out? We know it's not all Muslims. You don't need to say that. But Clinton said that, and I like that he said that. But I hated that Obama had to throw in the free speech as kind of an aside, and then always point out that of course we don't agree with it. It's like you know they were actually mentioning this guy who was going to burn Korans, the preacher in Florida.
Yeah.
Which to me was just such an unimportant story. Who gives a shit?
I know.
If one lone dumb wolf wants to burn Korans, fuck
I know.
Him. It's not worthy of the president mentioning some jackass who wants to do that. Let him do it.
Yeah,
it's his
and
freedom.
With the internet. Okay, if people are going to start rioting and murdering people because they don't like a trailer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If I hope the president mentions our movie, Women Aren't Funny, that's going to be premiering November 10th at Caroline's at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. Women Aren't Funny.
Nice
and
plug.
If the president sees that.
What's the date again?
November 10th at 1 o'clock.
I'm going to. Is there a trailer online? Because I'm going to riot and murder someone.
Yeah, very offended. See.
And the president will defend me.
Yes.
No, it sounds like a great movie.
Oh, it's really fun. Every comic's in it. Most comics.
I was just kind of happened to be here the other day. Rich's wife is a very funny comic. So
yeah, she's very liberal. She's from Canada, liberal, but she loves it. Whenever you,
bless
you know
her.
Why? Because you don't hold back. She loves the fact that you're not like some empowered, you know, you have a sense of humor, and she loves you.
Well, that's because I've always... Have I seen her at the Cellar?
Huh?
Have I seen her at the Cellar?
I don't know. No, she hasn't worked the Cellar.
Oh, okay.
No. She's had an HBO special. Very, very funny comic. Bonnie McFarlane.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I have seen her, because I know that name. I must have seen her
on
TV.
A lot of guys know the name, too.
Sorry, now I'm not being...
Oh, my God.
Interesting.
Yes, you are.
I want to bring up something about these Muslim extremists, and it's only
okay,
the extremists...
Okay, and then I'm going to have to go, because you kept me over my time.
I know. This is so much fun, I didn't even notice. I love having you on, absolutely. if the media presents this as, you know, it was the video, and that's what happened in the White House, even the video. Such an important story, such an important video, I gather. If it's just extremists, why is everybody so petrified that they wouldn't even play 1 second of the video of this huge story, the cause of our embassies being lit on fire?
Sure.
They wouldn't play a frame of that video on their on any of the news channels because they're petrified of a few extremists. Really, that's it.
Yeah, you're right.
Unless there's a little more than just a few extremists in Islam.
And what really bothers me is the costuming I did for that film is not getting the credit it deserves. I said no green screen. It looks stupid in the living room.
Green
the
screen the ground.
It was so
stupid.
So hilarious.
It would show how ridiculous it is. Like a lot of people didn't see it and have no clue. They have an image in their head of what it might be. When you see it, you're like, oh, please.
I know.
It's
I couldn't
so
even watch much of it because it was so bad.
I had to watch.
It was
the whole
like watching
thing.
Aaron Sorkin.
It was really.
I really want to keep watching this, but it's just so bad.
You can't green screen sand when they're walking on a floor, a green floor, and then put sand on it. It doesn't look right.
We have to plug Ann's book.
Yes.
It's mugged racial demagoguery from the 70s to Obama. And I love the fact that you wrote this about race. I love it because nobody nobody white is just talking right. about race honestly. And
that's
you know,
what I love about
the
I love about Angie. You're a brave woman. I like that. I like when people don't back down. When people try to get you and like, oh, that's a racist threat. You just tell them pretty much to go fuck themselves.
Yes.
And I love that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right. So
yeah.
Anne has to go, and I have to urinate.
and my face needs a wash.
All right, kid.
Thank
we'll
you.
Be
thank you.
Right back. Thanks, Anne.
Oh yeah, I think I have one.
This is the Opie and Anthony Channel on SiriusXM.
Oh, Mimi Beardsley, could you eat my ass? Mimi Beardsley, haven't you done this before? Mimi Beardsley, worst name ever. Mimi Beardsley, Mimi Beardsley. Oh, Mimi Beardsley, oh, my dick smells like Mimi Beardsley. Could you eat my ass? Fucking any Negroes. Oh, do you have any friends who'll eat my ass? Have some bootleg alcohol. Oh, you're a virgin, aren't you? Smell these poppers. Her name is horrible. It's a real cock softener. Why don't you take care of my baby brother? Oh, look, his cock went back into the left. Back into the left. His cock went back into the left. Back into the left. Mimi Beardsley, could you eat my ass? Mimi Beardsley, haven't you done this before? Mimi Beardsley, worst name ever. Mimi Beardsley, Mimi Beardsley. Oh, Mimi Beardsley. Oh, my dick smells like Mimi Beardsley. Could you eat my ass? Mimi Beardsley, worst name ever. Mimi Beardsley. His cock went back into the left. Back into the left. His cock went back into the left. Back into the left. His cock went back into the left. Back into the left. His cock went back into the left. Back into the left. Oh, Mimi Beardsley, could you eat my ass? Mimi Beardsley, haven't you done this before?
You're talking about the other Avengers, Rich Voss, not
yeah.
the comic book Avengers,
no.
but the one with the English guy and Emma Peel.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah,
I wasn't a big fan of the Avengers TV show.
Now here's what.
Hi, Opie and Anthony show. We're just rambling during commercials.
And here's my complaint, and you know deep down inside, because you try to go after the dumb Rich Voss character. Oh. I had nothing but good questions for her. Nothing but good ones. And
for Ann Coulter, who's just in.
You could say this and that, but the juice stuff, the young voting, all of it is legitimate questions. And deep down inside, you're going, fucking Voss, man, really knows what he's talking about.
It's got to be pretty deep down inside because I ain't seeing it.
You are seeing it. And you, because I saw you nodding going, yeah, I wish
I
thought of
that.
You know
what? Well, your juice stuff. I like your juice stuff.
Okay.
That's good.
Okay. The young kid, emotion, intellect.
I notice a lot of your tweets when you get political. It's always about Israel. You don't really pay much attention to what happens in your own country here, do you?
Well, because what happens here is going to backfire over to here.
Oh, is that it?
Well, the total anti-Semitism.
So goes Tel Aviv, so goes New York.
And what am I going to care about here? You can't, you know, just people are blind to everything, and you know that. They're fucking, they're stupid, they're blind, they don't look at both sides. You know what I would love to see? Ann Coulter and Rachel Maddow having a debate.
Oh,
that would fucking be.
You're going to get kinky or something.
No.
I think Coulter would destroy.
It would be.
I think she'd destroy. Yeah.
It would be.
Anne's very very well educated and knowledgeable about what she's talking about. Whenever. And it's what she does. You go on The View, those girls have to be able to talk about Justin Bieber and politics. So they're not too astute on
it's amazing how, I'm sorry to interrupt you, Ann.
Sure,
it's amazing how many people on Twitter are mad at our interview with Ann. Way to challenge her.
What?
I agree with a lot of what she says.
Of course.
I like Ann. She's my friend. I agree with a lot of what she says.
That's so fucking way to challenge her.
Yeah.
On what?
She, you know, I don't agree with her on gay marriage, but she's let her feel how she wants. I don't care. I might have to change her opinion.
Yeah, and you ain't gonna. Oh,
no.
My God. People are very politically polarized these days. It's you can't even bring up your point of view, someone else's point of view, without not even just getting into a debate about it, but, like, getting slammed.
Yeah. And the
getting
guy
called horrid things.
The guy said, how did you let Coulter just dismiss gay marriage so easily? Because I said I'm for it. I think they have the right to get married.
Jim didn't all of a sudden say, yeah, I'm against it too.
Yeah. That's one of the things I like. And it's also, it's not even about, of course I can have an argument with Ann. I mean, but she's my friend, and it's like, she wasn't here for that. Like, I didn't feel compelled to do it because it doesn't matter to me if she agrees with me on it. I don't need her to agree with me on it.
She wasn't here for a debate. I'm not going to debate you, Jerry.
Any more than I need to agree with her on certain things. Yeah. I just don't. Yeah. I've been very vocal about how I feel about that.
Yeah. When people are anti-gay marriage, automatically pro-gay marriage or gay or whatever turns it into anti-gay.
Right.
And they turn it into which is not anti-gay. It's more of a religious, traditional
a lot of times,
marriage thing. You know, a lot of times.
Well, yeah. I am not for gay marriage or against it. I don't fucking give a shit about the gays and them getting married. If they want to get married, I feel sure they should be able to. But I'm not going to fight for it.
Yeah,
I don't think it's something I got to worry about. Who gives a shit? I'm no zealot for the homosexuals.
Hello?
Whatever you want to do. How you doing there, Rich?
Who's still in the studio. It's Bonnie.
What's Bonnie doing?
What's Bonnie doing?
Hopefully seeing a lawyer.
Or a hitman.
What do you mean, how did it go? I'm still in the studio. Me and Anthony are having a very deep discussion.
Oh, boy. A discussion.
About what?
Huh?
No, no. Oh, Anthony doesn't play sports. We got to change the poster. I'll call you back later.
Yeah. No, I'm not.
Fuck, I wish. How did she get my number?
on your personal phone. Where were we, Rich? Because I was having a great
gay marriage.
Yeah, I don't care about the gays and their marriages.
The thing,
it doesn't bother me. I'm not against it, but I'm not. I don't have to sit there and jump on the bandwagon and be like, "Are you for gay marriage?" And if I say no, I'm called a homophobe.
Okay, and I get that too. But then you could be devil's advocate and go, "Well, what if someone said Italians can't get married?" You would have been happy about that years ago. But
yeah.
But you know what I mean. So there is a civil rights issue there. You know, but if you're a guest, it doesn't mean you're anti-gay, and that's what liberal. Another thing with liberals, if you don't agree with them on things, you're a right-wing lunatic.
But are anti-gay if you're anti-gay marriage, I think, because there's no other reason to be against it.
How about religion?
How about?
Sure, but religion is also. It says a lot of things that we look at as ridiculous.
Well, but just gay people that don't believe in gay marriage, how could they be anti-gay?
I don't believe. I don't know if a lot of gay people don't want to get married. I just don't think we have the right to tell other people they can't do it.
What if you do feel that the institution of marriage is this kind of sacred bond between a man and a woman, and you feel that it's being infringed upon by allowing two men to use that same institution. And since they're doing that, it's almost degrading what you're doing and what your marriage is.
Then I think you need to reevaluate how you view what you do. As opposed to, I, and again, it's a big, it's the way I feel about us being in Korea and the way I feel about us being in Germany. Mind our fucking business.
Well,
it's none of our business if people get married. I don't understand. She's religious too. I believe Anne is religious, and I think a lot of the religion, that's where a lot of that comes from, I think.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
When you're raised that, yeah, you know, with, and I just, it's, I can't comprehend it. I just don't, it's like, I never, and I've said this before, I never ever see any Americans saying, you should be able to do this, but I shouldn't. It's always, I can do this, and here's why you can't. You've never heard one group in this country stress how another person should be able to do something they can't do.
Mm-hmm.
It's always why my rights should be protected and yours shouldn't.
Let's say, Chick-fil-A, when they were against against gay marriage, and certain cities said, well, we're not going to allow you.
That's disgusting.
Okay,
you're right.
Okay. Yeah. Now, what if a company like Chick-fil-A came out and said, we are pro-gay marriage, and two cities said, we're not going to let you in?
Absolutely.
It would, it would be, you know.
Yeah.
Well, it was kind of criticized. Menino in Boston, was criticized. And Bloomberg actually stuck up for it. And I think it said, hey, you got to have your opinions. The problem with Chick-fil-A is I don't care if the guy's against gay marriage. But then people said he donates to a lot of anti-gay causes, like, you know, this family shit.
But is that any different, really, than just having the freedom of speech and freedom of being able to contribute to certain...
You should be able to, absolutely. But I could see why gays don't want to go to Chick-fil-A. It's almost like, I don't want to give my money to a guy who is directly contributing to a group that's against me.
Right.
You know, but he should say what he feels, sure.
Do you know how I fought the other night? I wanted to watch a movie, and Mel Gibson, some new movie that he was in, and I didn't do it because I'm going, why am I going to support a guy that hates me?
That's crazy. You're cutting off your big Jewish nose to smell your face. I can barely get it out.
But you're not. Who cares what he thinks?
Because what do you mean, who cares what he thinks?
I honestly, I like Farrakhan a lot.
So I really think he's a great speaker.
I enjoy Farrakhan.
Yeah.
He probably wouldn't like me.
No, he probably wouldn't.
Who cares?
I don't think he would.
I don't care.
But okay, would you donate money to the Nation of Islam?
No.
Okay.
But. And here's that's a good point, but the Nation of Islam is not an entertainment outlet that I enjoy.
Well.
Like, would I ever, like, there's been rap music I bought knowing that rappers were saying things I didn't agree. Eric B. and Rakim, I mean, they're not exactly a very pro-white. He would rap about, I think, like the 5%ers and fucking white people living in caves and all that stuff. I still bought his stuff, and I didn't agree with what he said. So I don't mind that. If I don't
white
care.
People living in caves?
Well, it's from the song called The Ghetto. But just, you know, it's like that Muslim view of, you know, white people come from caves and, you know, Dr. Yaqub or whatever.
They finally got out of the caves when the black guy moved in the cave next door.
I remember I've seen the Israelites. Remember those guys who used to be on the corner?
Yes.
And I'm sitting there.
Did they chase them out of Times Square? Still there?
I don't know.
The black Israelites?
But they were mean. And this guy sitting here goes, everybody's sitting around. He goes, we were the first on the planet. And I looked at him. I go, well, what went wrong? And
we had space travel before you even out of caves. Oh, really?
You know, it's just, I think there's more hypocrisy on the left than there is on the right. That's all. You know, I did a college once, Trenton State.
Oh.
Okay, no, and this is, and I did some professors walking through in the middle, doesn't know what's going on. And I said, whatever I said, it could have been something Polish, Irish, whatever hacky thing in a college you say, okay? He tried not to get me paid. He didn't even know the show. He just heard one sentence. But yet, 2 weeks later, Khalid Abdul-Mohammed was speaking at that college. Right. Do you remember who Khalid Mohammed was?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah.
He got kicked out of the Nation of Islam for... I mean, they...
He was a little too radical.
They were kind of like, look, we hate Jews, but you know what? You got to draw the line on hate. So that's the hypocrisy, I think, leans a little more to the left
than
the right.
I think conservatives are a bit more consistent. Like, even though I don't agree with them on a lot, but I think that they've been more consistent. Like, I kind of always know where they haven't let me down. I'm never shocked when they take a position because it's kind of what I expect conservatives to do.
Yeah.
Like, you know... I'm just not surprised by it. But when liberals disappoint me because I want to be one. I want to be a liberal.
Do you want to be a liberal?
Yes, I do.
Now, why, though?
Because I agree with them on so many social things. And even though they're politically correct idiots, our jobs are in much better shape when liberals are in charge because they're not targeting, they're not actively targeting pornography. Like the FCC, look at the beatings the FCC has taken in the last couple of years in court. And again, they're losing steam. And part of that is, I know the president's not directly, but shit rolls downhill.
Yeah, but liberals want to silence conservative radio. They want to silence.
No, they don't. They just know they're getting their asses kicked, and they just want an equal shot. And I disagree with them totally. They're being fucking babies.
That is true. I got to agree with you on that one, because there was a time under Bush where you could not fucking say shit.
Tenfold.
And people were being fired, and the fines that were going out on radio. And we were like, you know what? It usually comes back around and changes for the other way over time. And it has. I mean, no one's really, you're not hearing about these giant fines being levied and people really getting thrown off the air.
Who do you think went after Tosh, Imus, all of them? They weren't conservatives. Those were liberals.
No, I understand that.
That attack, that ruined those, that try to ruin those
careers. Interest groups.
Yeah, interest groups. Yeah. I'm talking about, like, the fines that the FCC... I'm talking when the FCC comes after you, like, you know, the government. And the fines were $35,000 per offense. Now they're $350,000. That went under Bush. They went tenfold. So radio companies panicked. And it got a lot worse under him. And there's much worse. And I felt it. Even though the liberals are the politically correct fucking babies and they annoy me, the arch religious conservatives actively target it.
I mean,
obscenity.
But now you got to make a choice between, can I come in here and say what I want with less fear that I'm going to get fired, or can I come in here and work and not be able to keep the money I fucking earned being here? Because that's pretty much what it's boiled down to.
That's why you need another party. That's the problem. That's what we get.
I have parties all the time.
Yeah, me too. I like the fucking party. I fucking just play my music. So fucking loud, your ears will fall out.
I bet you.
But that's the problem. You're right.
Yeah, yeah.
You have fucking two choices. It stinks.
But there's no fucking inkling that a third party is ever going to break through.
Libertarians.
There's no light at the end of the tunnel here. The amount of money that has been spent between the Republicans and Democrats this election is astounding. And there's no third party that could afford to jump in this fray and have any legitimacy and be able to compete with money like that. It's like the fucking Yankees. The money that goes in, that's what you're getting the result of.
You know how Ross Perot competed? Because he was a rich guy. And he was able to fund everything. And he blew it. I think he still got 17%, which hurt Bush Sr.
Uh-huh.
But I think he took 17% of the vote, and he fell apart at the end and got weird.
Oh, yeah.
He had a really good shot, and
He was in it to hurt Bush. He was in it because
he wanted to win, though.
He wanted Clinton. That was planned.
No, he wanted to win. Nobody doesn't want to be president. He wanted to win, and he just got fucking weird at the end. They're trying to sabotage my daughter's wedding. He just got bizarre.
Yes,
Stockdale was not a good choice for vice president, and he blew it. And maybe he wouldn't have won anyway. But even fucking up, he got 17%. And that's what... What's that?
19.
Oh, was it 19%? Wow, okay.
Wow, that's
dude, that's a
big.
Lot.
That's pretty big.
Considering, and what did Clinton win with? Can you 30-something, or was it, can you look that up?
Damn.
But, I mean, he did really well.
I didn't think he got that much of
Bush
the
kind of gave, Bush Sr.,
he had a terrible campaign.
He fucking didn't care anymore. He was done.
42?
Clinton got 43.
43?
No. Bush got 37.5. Perot got 18.9.
Oh, wow.
18, but almost 19%. That's a third party right there. And he fucked up and got that. Let's say he didn't fuck up and still lost. Let's say he got 23% of the vote. That's a fucking real, that is a real run at it.
That's a contender.
And that's only 20 years ago. And no one has stepped in since.
20 years?
92. Mm-hmm.
Jesus, that's a long time ago.
It's the last time I voted.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
I won't vote again.
I'm going to vote. No good candidate had been sent. I'm going to vote this year, though.
Yeah?
I'm going to vote for Ron Paul, yeah.
Ron Paul?
I don't care if it's a wasted vote.
No, it doesn't matter. It's New York. All our vote is a wasted fucking vote.
Why? Because it's all Democrat.
It's all going. Yeah, it's all going to Obama anyway.
I don't know. You know, I think
not New York. Stop it. Not New York. No fucking way. New York ever goes anywhere but Democrat. It's insane. You just got to vote for the other elections.
But that's only New York City. I'm talking New York State. New York State.
No, the entire state goes Democrat
every completely.
Year. Yeah. That's it. You're not a swing state. It's only swing states vote for the president.
Which, by the way, I've said before, they're the only states that think. If you're a swing state, you're in one of the four states that actually thinks in this dumb country.
Might vote Republican, might vote Democrat. Depends on what they have to say.
You're one of only four states that your votes have to be earned.
How sick is that?
Where are they? Ohio, Florida. Is Pennsylvania a swing state or no?
No, they're...
Ohio, Florida.
Virginia, West Virginia?
I don't know. I don't even know what they are.
All right. I have a question for you. If
North Carolina?
If California is so liberal, I mean, that's definitely a Democratic state, right? How come, and same with Massachusetts, how do they elect a Republican governor in both of these states?
Because that's how bad the Democrats were. They elected a Republican mayor here for 8 years, Giuliani.
It does take
a terrible Democrat.
Well, so that you don't think they can look at that when it comes to the president?
It's electoral college.
Nevada. Nevada is your swing state.
Another thing about Nevada.
Wisconsin is your swing state.
Nevada and Florida, both a lot of transplants.
Colorado, Iowa,
North Carolina.
Wisconsin, Ohio, Virginia, North Carolina.
What's that? A swing state is a state that'll get another state and go and sleep with two other states? Get it? Swinger states? Hey, they're not all good.
How about if some of them were?
At Bananas this weekend in Hasbrook Heights, they will be.
Yes.
Friday and Saturday at Bananas.
And, Jimmy, where are you going?
I don't have any gigs. I have October 19th. I'm doing the Club Madrid in Nevada, right outside Vegas.
Ooh.
And 15th to 26th, 24th, 25th, 26th, I think, in Philadelphia, the Helium. My first time there.
You're going to love it.
They added a Thursday show, so there's two shows on the Thursday as well as two Friday, two Saturday. And I am returning to Addison for the Improv and a couple of the gigs that will be announced very soon, and we're still working on my website. They're really taking their fucking time doing my website.
Bastards.
25 through 27. And October 9th, I'm at the Dark Comedy Festival in Toronto.
You travel a lot.
What's the Dark Comedy Festival?
I don't know. It's just...
Dark?
Yeah. I guess moody.
Oh, boy.
Melancholy.
Oh, see, I was under the impression...
How come sad black people aren't called melanin collie?
And this past season on Comedy Central, I won't be on The Burn.
Why didn't they go on The Burn?
Yeah, what happened?
I did an episode. It was fun.
Yeah.
Did you ask?
I don't ask. You don't ask.
Why can't you ask?
You don't ask.
Oh, okay.
Jim, myself, and Keith Robinson taped a little non-air pilot. Hopefully it'll go. We had a great time and great acting from all three of us.
Well,
I'm telling you, I was at a whole nother level. I'm at another level in life.
Was it Louis Beans good?
No, listen, you guys fucking sabotaged me. Back in the day when I let that shit happen, because now Travis said come in at 7 today, and I called him, I go, what the fuck do you have planned? Because I'm not going for that. You know, some kind of, you know, you're going to hook me up to monitors.
Rich is very paranoid. Anytime I ask him to come in earlier,
because I don't know what you have planned. Like, you're going to throw a script at me or make me fucking, show the bumps on my cock. I don't fucking
know. What's that mark on your arm?
This?
Yeah, it's like a weird little pattern. It looks like a notebook was resting against it. What the fuck is that?
Oh, maybe he was leaning on something. Were you leaning on?
Watch. Oh, your watch.
Oh, your watch band.
Which is a really weird... It looks like indentation. It looks like
an alien, like I'm fucking, was stamped.
Oh, my God.
anyhow, what I'm saying is November 10th, sneak preview of our movie. Are you guys going to come?
November 10th.
I'd love to watch every comic but me do something. Sure.
Saturday at 1?
What are you doing in it? Yes.
Saturday at 1?
You have a bigger part than
a
Chris
or
Rock.
P.
Shut up.
1 o'clock in the afternoon.
I'm actually flying home from Toronto. That's the day after I do Toronto.
Oh, so you'll be back by 1? What time will you be back?
We land at 12:59.
I don't believe it.
You know what? I'd rather see it with the regular people.
What do you mean the regular people?
In a theater.
It's going to be a fucking great event.
At Caroline's?
Yeah, it's during the New York Comedy Festival.
Pull that little screen down behind the stage. Yeah. I'll see it on the big screen.
No, you probably never will.
Why?
Because it'll probably go straight to either HBO, Showtime, or Movies on Demand.
That'd be good. Then
so
I can
see it on your big screen.
My theater in my basement. I got a movie theater in my house. Rich, come on.
I know, I've been to your house.
I know.
Up.
Amongst your people that I'm surrounded by.
Oh, really?
I people live in a very Jewish neighborhood. Yeah, that's it. Morons.
Fucking cocksuckers, right?
Yeah. Jesus.
I think you're amazed on how brilliant I really am.
You're amazed on how brilliant I am.
It's the Jews from the belt.
I think you're amazed how on how brilliant I am.
Holy fuck.
Fox News has the hottest chicks.
Holy fuck,
it's just the way it goes. And MSNBC is a load of dog shit as far as their women go. Just awful. Fox just has... Who's that fucking little strawberry blonde redhead they got before Megyn Kelly comes on?
Bill Burr?
Yes, Bill Burr. He's beautiful.
Did you see the news story with a fat newscaster?
Yes, we talked about her yesterday.
Oh,
the victim.
It was one fucking email.
That's
not bullying.
It wasn't even a fucking bullying.
That she made public.
She was bullied, I think.
Okay, and here's the thing. She took out about 5 minutes of news time to talk about her fatness.
Well, it was an expose.
When people are having their clits cut off around the world, okay?
Is that
happening? There's fucking slavery, all right? Yeah. And she's like, you know what? Treadmill.
It's a bigger issue.
Is that her name?
What's a bigger issue? People are using this whole fucking bullying thing. Everybody's a bully now. If you don't agree with... If you point out, you know, look, here comes that drunk. Oh, quit bullying me. Well, no, quit drinking. Not you, I mean. I'm just saying in general.
I would love to continue this, but my good friend, director, Ty West is on the phone.
Oh.
And let's plunk that down. Ty!
Ty West, what are you hanging around someone's neck under a shirt collar or something?
That's right, Chip.
Jesus.
Fucking clothing jokes. Take us home, fatso.
No. Jesus Christ. Where are you, Ty?
I am in Savannah, Georgia, having a mint julep.
Ah, mint julep down there in Savannah, Georgia. What's going on down there?
I am finally making a new movie down here, and filmmaking is on sale in Georgia, so that's why we're down here.
Is that it? These cities, like some of these cities really kind of give you guys a good break.
Big tax breaks.
Yeah, they give you, I think Georgia gives you 30% of what you spend here back. So you come here and deal with all the terrible crew, so that way you can save money.
Wow.
And you just spend it on fixing everything.
Fucking
are the crews bad, though? Is that the disadvantage?
It depends on where you are. I mean, if you're, like, in Atlanta, that's where most of the crews are in Georgia. But also, if you're in Atlanta, you're competing with, like, the Hunger Games sequel. And so all the good crews are going to be on that movie. So you're going to get, like,
you don't even think about that, yeah.
And if you're in Savannah... you're going to get the D team, but then they all left to go be on Hunger Games, so you're going to get, like, the F team.
Wow.
But, we found some good people, but it's when you first get here, it's a struggle.
You get the Housewives crew.
China. And then, man, a little-known fact, you can drink on the street here, so it gets pretty wild.
Wow, that sounds like fun. Nobody can hassle you? No cops can fucking hassle you?
Yeah, I think the cops have, depending on your skin tone, I think they still hassle you.
I gotcha.
It is Georgia.
Yeah, it is still the South. The Deep South. What's the movie about?
I'm trying to keep it quiet so as to jinx it, but it's called The Sacrament, and it's a movie that I'm doing with that guy, Eli Roth, who did, you know, Hostel and all those movies.
Uh-huh.
And it's a rather dark one. I'm trying to keep it secret until we wrap, which we wrap in about a month and a half, because I just would rather just get through this one before anything go wrong. Because it's a little bit controversial, so I'm trying to I'll loop back around on that one. But it's definitely, whereas The Innkeepers was sort of a fun ghost story, this is not that. This is a much darker movie. But I'm pretty excited about it, so it's so far so good. We've built this gigantic set, which is the biggest set I've ever built, so, it should be interesting.
Oh, really? A nice giant set. Is this the longest shoot you've been on? Because you usually wrap things up in like 2 weeks.
No, I mean, it's almost the longest. But see, what happens is you go to these places to make a movie, and they go, you've got 25 days to shoot and 4 weeks to prep. And then about a week after getting there, you're like, can you prep it in 2 weeks and shoot it in 10 days? And so the same sort of happens on this movie. It's not quite as short as, say, the last one, but, every time you cut out a day, it saves so much money, so everyone tries to... do that to you. But we're doing all right. So far, so good.
Yeah. How are the Disney plans going?
Ah, yes. Thank you for those updates. I texted Anthony earlier this week because I am following the Cumia relationship model of bringing a girl to Disney for the weekend.
Sure.
It's my birthday this weekend. So,
oh.
Disney's about a four-hour drive, so I thought, what better than to fly a crazy ex-girlfriend to Disney World? It's going good. You know what I learned, though, is that it's Columbus Day, which is going to be a nightmare.
Because
I was looking at the hotels, and they were all sold out. And I was like, you got to be kidding me, sold out. And then that's the answer. But I think I worked it out by just spending an exuberant amount of money.
Yeah, there's always rooms if you spend enough money. But you're into, like, karaoke and shit, right?
I am.
Yeah, see, they got a good karaoke bar right there. I think it's at the Swan or the Dolphin, one of the two.
I've made Epcot reservations. I've done the whole thing.
Oh,
so, but this
nice.
Is my, you know, it's my last weekend before just the shit hits the fan for a while, so I figure, whatever, I'm going for it.
Yeah, and it's an ex-girlfriend?
Yes, of many times over.
Oh,
it's
no.
A very healthy scenario.
What keeps you coming back?
What do you think?
Well, that's probably not the best idea.
Every once in a while you run into them and you think, this seems like a good idea again, and it's not. But, you know, it's the last weekend before the movie, so why not?
You're sticking your pecker in her, I bet.
Jim, come on, man.
That's what I would do, just stick my pecker in.
Relax.
I've gone a lot further for a lot less. So.
I don't think it's ever worked out with an ex, like, romantically again. I've had friendships with exes. One of them threw a glass at me, a bottle at me in my jacuzzi.
And you drank right?
And I drank it up before it hit me. And I had to tell her, that's it. Take it easy. I don't want to fucking hang out with you anymore. And that lasted for like months. And now she knows to fucking behave if she comes over the house. You fucking behave. You got
to
teach these girls.
I would like to say that this time around, I know what's going on, and I'm not worried. But we'll see. Talk to me in a month when I'm sort of like in love or something again. But I'd like to think I've got a good. I'm grounded this time around. I think third time's the charm for at least not acting like an idiot. But
do you use movies to like? Oh, I'll put you in a movie.
Well, I don't do that, but that's how it sort of started. And it's also not a coincidence that I'm making a new movie and suddenly she's back in my life. I mean, it's all very predictable.
Is she?
But,
she's not in the movie, is she?
She's not, no.
Oh, I was going to say.
But, you know.
It could get dangerous, I would think, with a guy that makes movies to put, like, lousy actresses in just because you want to fuck them. That would really kind of ruin
it. Every shitty movie you've ever seen was made for that reason.
Yes.
The producer wanted to fuck the actress, and that's why she's in the movie.
No, I mean, it certainly happens a lot. I mean, I think, I can tell you from my perspective, the thought happens a lot more than it actually happening. Like, when you're casting a movie, you definitely are like, well, this would be great, but I can't do it because it'll destroy the movie. But it definitely enters your mind.
Can't you give him a smaller part?
At least a callback.
It also enters your mind, but you know, it depends. I think it's weird when you make a movie. Like sometimes the experience is just really traumatic and just very work oriented, and then sometimes because everyone's like in it doing the same thing, there's like a summer camp vibe, and that's why when you hear like actors dating actors or directors dating actors, it's because you spend like 4 months in something like Savannah, Georgia, with like these are the only people you kind of know and get along with there, so you form these kind of like. Pretty intense relationships, so that's how that stuff always happens. And it's like it's happened to me before, but like it's but then sometimes you're just there being like, I hate everybody, I just want to make this movie and go home.
Yeah, it must seem sometimes like a fucking Pee-wee's Playhouse atmosphere.
Definitely.
where everybody just kind of we're in love, this is great, a little whirlwind romance, and then you get back to the real world and it doesn't quite work.
It is weird when you go back to normal life.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, we don't have to see each other like every day on specific hours and be doing things that make us seem really cool and professional. Like we go back and like, what are you doing? Watching Netflix. And then,
yeah.
You know, it's just,
all of a sudden it's like, oh.
As another movie maker, this is Rich Voss.
Oh, Rich Voss, yes.
Rich makes child pornography.
No. We made a documentary, which we've been 3 years on, and we're having major problems with the color correction and the online, because it was shot on so many different cameras.
The online.
Yeah, that's movie talk, Anthony.
Oh, is it?
Yes. He knows what I'm talking about.
I'm following you.
So, I mean, is there a like a shortcut to get through this, or you don't have no idea what we're going through.
Fix it in post.
In post.
Also, I hate to say this, it's going to get worse if you sell it to a company. Delivering it is going to be your next nightmare. No, I mean, this is why, like, making movies is a terrible thing to do, is because it starts out as a really fun, cool idea, and then everything just starts making you, like, wish you didn't do it. You know, I mean, the best thing you can probably do is, you know, as far as color correcting, you know, find a place that's, like, going to work with you as best as possible. Even if it's not the best place, at least it's spiked on the project.
But I'm using Microsoft Paint on it.
No, but here's the thing. Everybody has different... You got to bring it in different... Like, MOD has a different spec than Showtime or HBO. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, so, I mean, the short answer is it's going to cost you a lot of money.
There you go. Throw money at it, Rich.
I'm going fucking broke with this movie.
I don't doubt it.
I'm writing a movie.
What is it?
It's about where I'm a detective, and I'm going to get President Obama to be my sidekick.
That doesn't sound very...
Who's going to play Obama?
He is.
Oh, really? Uh-huh. Have you put in a call?
Yeah, I sent the script already. I hear he likes it.
Yeah?
Yeah. He just says, Chippison, no.
Oh, God. You're not even changing your name. Your character in the movie is still Chip Chipperson.
Yeah, I am.
I'm brilliant. Ty, what do you got going on? You plugging anything?
I am, actually. I'm calling in for this movie called VHS.
Oh, fuck. I saw that. When I went to bed last night, it was on demand.
On demand. VHS is this weird movie I had at Sundance last year that it made people sick. It made people pass out and stuff. But I don't think it's because they were scared. I think they were just drunk and had bad sushi at weird altitudes. But it's an anthology movie, much like Creepshow. And it's this sort of, as much as I hate to say, it's like this found footage anthology, because everybody groans and rolls their eyes at that type movie these days. I don't think it's as much of a bummer as those movies usually are. So it's this movie about these kind of like misfit guys that break into this house and they find all these VHS tapes, and then when they play the tapes, a different director made a segment. So it becomes an anthology movie like Creepshow or Tales from the Crypt or something like that. And different directors did one. So I did one. There's five of them. So, like, if you hate mine, you might like one of the other ones.
Yeah.
Or if, you know, vice versa. So it kind of works out well for everybody.
Who's in yours?
Is it horror?
It is horror, yes. It's kind of nobody's because it has to seem real. I mean, I'll say the one thing about this movie not being annoying that it's found footage is there's no, like, these tapes were discovered in a basement and this is real and you're really seeing ghosts. It's pretty, it's very aware that it's a movie.
Right.
So it's really just a scary movie, which is good that it's, like, you know, Halloween time. So maybe you could get it on demand, or maybe you could go see it in the theater and you could go, maybe you take a lady friend. Maybe if you're a fan of this show, you just watch it by yourself. Either or. Mm. And, like, it's pretty scary because I didn't see any of the other ones until it was all done. I had only seen mine.
Yeah.
So when I saw all the other ones, I was pretty surprised how, I mean, they're all very different. Some of them are really gory. Some of them are really suspenseful. And there's a lot of different good techniques. Like, one of them is just a Skype conversation, which is pretty interesting. And mine is about a couple that goes on a road trip. And they go to, like, the Southwest, and they're filming their road trip, like a home video. And someone is, like, filming them while they sleep and with their camera, so it's like intercut, and it's kind of like the build up to how those two meet each other. But it's a cool movie, and people liked it a lot more than I anticipated them liking it. And it was a weird little project that I did in like a weekend, and it turned into this big thing. So so it comes out Friday. I think in New York it'll be at the Sunshine, and it will be in pretty much every city Friday. And it's also on demand right now, so
yeah,
it is October, so you can take advantage of the Halloween time.
Very scary. Have you seen online that fucking Slenderman stuff?
Oh, is that like a YouTube thing?
Like a YouTube thing that these guys have been doing and stuff. It's, you know, obviously the acting and everything and the story is kind of weird and everything. But boy, they sure got creepy with that Slenderman thing.
Yeah.
Like, he kind of just is there in the woods and kind of jumps out at you. Yeah, that was kind of creepy. I was watching some of that shit, but anything scares me too. I'm a fraidy cat when it comes to scary movies.
Yeah.
Anything you could take a little kitten, but if you make them do that weird movement, jumpy movement, I'm gonna have the shit scared out of me. Look, it's adorable. Ah, what's it doing?
I'm making a horror movie.
What are you making? What's your horror movie?
It's about Halloween too. It's like the ghost on the door that hangs turns out to be a real ghost.
horrible. How does that
don't
work?
Spoil the ending.
Yeah. No, but he's committing a lot of terrorist bombings.
Stupid.
Yeah. And
I don't get it.
And I figured I'm sleeping in bed and I hear boo Chipperson. Boo.
Does it have a
yeah,
name?
Exactly. It's called everyone that he's ever told a joke to. shit. All right, Ty. When did you say this weekend?
VHS, yeah, Friday comes out, and it's on VOD right now for the rest of the month. So
cool, man.
Many ways to see it.
All right, enjoy Disney.
I will.
And let me know how that works out for you.
You already know, but yeah. I will. I'll keep you updated.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool, man. I'll talk to you soon. Take it easy.
All right, thanks a lot, guys.
All right, brother.
RichFlash.com. Later. You people are hilarious on fucking chat and everything.
What is that?
It's like Anthony's banking that this guy's going to pull a Peter Jackson. No, Ty's fun, man.
I like Ty.
He's fun to like hang out with, too. He's just a good guy.
What just is that? Taken
filmmaker.
2?
Yeah, how many times?
Taken 2
comes out today.
You would think the first time after the kill was snatched, they
right.
would learn.
Well, they know? Didn't learn.
Is she in it again?
Oh, yeah.
Who's taken this time? The wife? The
what is the gimmick here? What's the synopsis?
I think someone steals his soy sauce and his hair begins to gray. So he has no idea
his
what to
do. Soy sauce. I love the soy sauce hair dye.
You want the synopsis? No.
Yes, yeah. Give me a synopsis.
Him and his wife are taken?
Well, let's find out, Sam.
Oh.
Former government agent Brian Mills has retired and attempts to reassemble his old life after years of overseas employment have left him estranged from his teenage daughter.
Boy. That was the last movie.
But when she is kidnapped while in Europe, Brian must revert to his old skill set to rescue her.
That's the first one.
What are you doing?
Oh, it says Taken.
Yeah,
oh.
Taken.
Anyway.
Taken 2, you zilch.
I am on Taken 2.
His daughter runs.
Info.
She was taken by people who wanted to be taught clunky running.
Yeah, she's not going back to Europe after she was taken.
Taken 2,
sound
they,
like it.
They okay. take him and his wife.
A year after the events in Paris on a trip to Istanbul, Brian Mills gets a surprise visit from his daughter Kim and his ex-wife Lenore.
Uh-huh.
The happy reunion turns sour when Lenore is taken by people who work for name I can't pronounce.
The wife now gets taken?
Yes, the employer of the men working in the Paris building where Kim's friend Amanda was found dead and the father of Marco Hoxha.
Yuck.
Brian killed in a previous film.
Oh,
with Lenore held hostage and Kim on the run.
Yuck.
Mills must utilize all his lethal skills to rescue
yes.
them. And
what
eliminate
are you going
to
do? What yeah. I do best.
Yes.
Oh, God.
I thought he's got a certain set of skills.
At least it's getting good reviews, though.
Is it?
No.
It's not right.
10%.
That fucking first one stunk.
What, are you kidding me? Taking one?
Shut up. It was awful.
It was great.
It stunk.
It was fucking great.
A
how he
terrible
just beat
story.
Everybody up. I loved it.
Yeah, it was like predictable it. Garbage.
Yeah, well,
it was shit.
I kind of liked it.
Don't
stunk.
Fucking don't be scared of him. You loved it.
It was terrible.
No.
It was a terrible movie. I love Liam Neeson. I think he's amazing. Her big, dad, stepdad, have pony. You know? And then at the end, he brings the fucking big singer. Yeah. I saved her life. Oh, it was fucking horrendous.
It was good action, though. I mean, it was
the
good.
Action was good,
yeah.
Yes. But
yeah,
so
yeah.
what?
I did kind of like how he was very brutal. Especially
yeah.
with that family when he walked yeah. in and just shot the fucking
when he
where's
said,
my
I'm
daughter?
Kill
where's,
you?
Where's my daughter?
Where's my daughter?
Yeah.
They have my daughter.
Forrest.
Are you watching?
His hair is dark, Forrest, like my fat Asian wife, Susan. She's got black hair, just like Liam Neeson.
Do you watch Sons of Anarchy?
No.
Yeah.
How fucking great was it when he was walking with the prison guard and goes, I'm going to get out of here.
Yeah.
I'm going to find where you live, and I'm going to kill you.
Oh, boy.
It was fucking the best scene.
Not realistic,
yeah.
though.
What do you mean not realistic?
Well, how's he going to do that?
Well, the whole show is terribly
yeah.
unrealistic.
Yeah, there's some fucking into 20 people killed an episode.
Getting into gunfights.
Yeah.
In this little town in California that doesn't even exist.
I know. And Breaking Bad's realistic, okay? There's been 400 murders, not one solved in that show. Okay. All right.
Well, Walter's very
yeah.
sly.
Yeah.
He
yeah.
knows how to cover things
yeah.
up. And
he went from a likable cancer guy to a fucking ruthless drug dealer.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's the whole arc
yeah.
of the story.
Text.
At least the fucking color corrections, right, you fucking amateur.
Text from Greg Hughes.
Oh.
Baby sister has been born. Everyone is doing great. Yes, you can announce.
Well,
so Opie is now the father of two children, a son and a daughter. So congratulations, man.
My daughter.
Oh, I didn't know she was pregnant. I thought she was just gaining weight.
Jesus.
That's great.
Oh, wow. That's it. No name? Any name?
He did not say.
He was leaning towards Opetta, though.
Opetta.
I said
Opetta.
Opetta Gregoria Hughes.
What a horrible man. Opetta.
I spoke to him privately, and he was leaning towards Opetta Gregoria.
She went in last night.
Opetta Gregoria.
Yeah, that's a good name.
That's a terrible name.
Oh. Wow.
I hope he's got two kids now.
Yeah. That's weird. Two children.
Yeah.
Two children. Oh, well, now it starts for him.
He sent me a text earlier. I've been texting with him one morning. He said, he wrote before, been in hospital 14 hours, nothing to report. And I asked how his wife was. She says she's good. And then I said, we're playing some audio from the first day. And he goes, how bad is it? I'm like, that was fun.
Wow,
he's got two kids now.
So now Rich.
What's that?
What is that like, the difference between one kid and two kids?
Nothing for Opie because she's a millionaire.
Does that make a big difference? Yeah, how about for enough money to buy anything?
Yeah, but for an average, much older man in a child's hat.
Hold on. Okay.
Hello? Do you want
to know something?
Yeah.
The fans got anxious that we didn't do Jocktober.
They did.
So they attacked Boss's Facebook page.
What's that?
Just because they wanted to do something. They had to do something.
Can we see it? What happened?
Oh, boy.
Nothing. We usually do Jocktober. We didn't do Jocktober today.
No, we didn't.
Because Opie wasn't here. I didn't know Opie wasn't coming in. We played a little bit of audio.
Yeah, Jocktober is something like, you know, we'll have everybody here. You know, yeah, we'll do it tomorrow. I mean, we didn't have to do it every day.
Good one that says, I think, comedian.
It's kind of fun.
Well, normally they've been attacking the... Oh, sorry.
You missed it.
Yeah. You poked his weenie.
Yeah. I just poked Rich's penis.
Oh, God.
Let me see.
What is this?
Your Facebook page?
That's your Facebook page.
They wanted to attack something, so they attacked you.
Oh, I don't give a fuck.
So they attacked...
The Rich Ross comedian.
Picture of Opie since October, I was howling.
A douche. There's a douche. People got so rambunctious, they wanted to attack some site. So Rich, they decided...
Good for them.
Why not you? Because they're kind of blaming you that we didn't do Jocktober here.
We also played stuff in the first
show. Of course, yes.
What did they do? They just put up pictures and...
Yeah,
they didn't get in. They don't know the password.
No.
Oh.
What is
you haven't announced
that
yet.
What is the password then? Sure.
Still one of my favorite things that ever happened on this show.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
When we each took possession over
fucking
Rich
great.
Voss's identity.
Rich Voss gave his password out. What a dummy.
Oh, I'm stretching like a big boy.
Oh, how'd you sleep?
I went to bed. The new apnea machine is not going well.
Why?
First of all, I think they put me on the wrong machine, but it's a BiPAP, and it's just I'm not getting. I'm still panicking when
you
I breathe.
Stick it up your ass. I think it's the wrong machine.
Yes. So I'm gonna actually hack into it, quote unquote, and reset it. I think that the settings are a little off.
You're gonna do your act in front of it.
Oh God.
That was a great one in 1992.
Shut up, hack.
What do you mean hack into it?
I know how to reset it.
What?
I'm not supposed
to. That sounds dangerous.
It's not.
Hope you choke.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jimmy.
I'll be okay.
Don't rehack it. Just take it back.
Doesn't work that way.
Why, eBay doesn't take them back? Can you get one of those on eBay, you think?
I hope you do. I hope you do. It's staph infection in it.
Yeah, how do you keep that shit clean? Like, doesn't the mask get all fucked up
full
from drool and shit? Dandruff and drool? No?
Well, you have to wash it.
Yeah?
Like, you wash it out in the morning. It's not bad. But you can't get much done in 9 minutes. I take it off every night because I'm so tired and I know I can't sleep like that. Or I doze off and I wake up gasping. That's why I think it's set wrong.
What happens if you cough up cum from the day before? Mm. Like,
well, and the mask keeps it so I can re-drink it, of course. That's the beauty. I mean, who wants to waste it? But no, you know what will smell? Sometimes I wear that mouth guard. Rogan recommended it. You can enjoy it like that. The one I did the wonderful Brando impression.
Yes.
And that you have to wash in the morning. I brush it, like teeth.
Really? Otherwise, like dentures?
Yeah.
Like dentures?
Yeah.
God, it's such a chore being you to sleep.
Sleeping.
Look at this fucking movie. Crazy. Seven Psychopaths. It's got everybody in it.
Oh.
Yeah.
Christopher Walken, fucking Sam Rockwell. Had a bunch of people.
I saw it. That's, movies usually have a bunch of people in
them. Celebrities.
Movies. Yeah, but these were celebrities. Yeah, they're in movies. By the way, Taken 2, 10% on Rotten Tomatoes. Is it even out?
Comes out today.
Oh.
Today. It's Thursday.
Oh.
What's the 97?
I'm thinking it's Friday.
You've been wrong about everything as far as Taken 2 goes.
Comes out tomorrow.
I'm going to watch it.
What, I thought they come out on Wednesdays.
Hush now.
Hey, who's...
I'm only playing.
Who's what?
Nothing.
Oh, okay.
Go ahead, say it, boy.
Very rich.
Oh, you know what? This kid is doing a fucking blind fundraiser. He asked me to ask you to do it.
Yeah, tell him I can't. Tell him I'll see.
I'll see.
Me, Colin, Robert Klein.
I think I am. When is that?
I don't know. I could tell you. It's like, it's a for the
check blind. The goddamn calendar.
I'll tell you right now.
Look, can I mention something about Robert Klein? I'm not.
I love him.
Look, I'm not
I
a cop.
I love him.
Jesus. Lost his page. Somebody, someone fucking in.
You're going to get to phase two soon.
It's his.
What's going to happen? How do I get that stuff off?
You don't.
Prolapsed anus.
First, you have to start blocking people. Then you have to shut down your wall. And then you have to take your Facebook page
just
down.
Just leave it there.
Oh, God damn it.
Oh, look, a doodie is coming out. Yay!
Oh, God.
Some black guy fucking E-Rock.
He's a big fat guy.
This is disgusting.
I'm keeping that one.
It's terrible. Yeah, I think Robert Klein, by the way.
Prolapse anus.
Big puffed up vagina. Oh, God. Now they're showing like genital herpes. Oh, God. Fuck. No.
There's mucus going from a nose into a mouth.
Blew a snot rocket into some woman's mouth.
You don't like that one, Ant?
No, that's horrible.
Why did they do this?
That's Brazilian porn.
We've moved on.
I can't look.
What else you got? I love that.
I can't look.
But that girl has nice tits, but that's fucking terrible.
Oh, God. Yeah, Robert Klein.
Nigga, you gay.
Oh, look at that picture of E-Rock they posted.
Robert Klein was considered a genius.
Yeah, he is. E-Rock, how old are you in that photo? Sorry, man. That's actually recent, right?
I'm 34.
In that photo?
Oh,
yeah. Can't believe he took that photo.
I look amazing.
Oh, you look horrible in that picture. Such a bad move.
Death wish is me.
When is it?
And I don't think he's very funny.
He is a genius. I love him.
Who, Robert Klein? He's had fucking 9 specials.
Yeah, whatever.
1 hour specials.
And let me tell you something. Early on, he was very entertaining. One of those genius kind of comics. Fuck, I can't look at that.
That bothers you? Who cares?
It's a boogie. It's really bad.
It's a girl blowing spit white snot from her nose into the other girl's mouth.
I can't look at that.
Imagine sucking that down like a big oyster. That salty consistency.
I mean, how can that fucking sexually arouse anybody?
It's just sexy. You fucking suck down that. It's got the consistency of spit, but it's a viscousy booger and it's fucking salty.
No.
You suck it right down like an oyster, man.
What do I got to do for
this? How do people eat fucking snot?
The top of that would get stuck in your teeth, too, like a piece of string.
How do people eat snot?
A piece of string.
I don't get it.
You have to close your wall, and then you could temporarily take your Facebook page offline.
Fuck.
Wait, what were we just talking about? It?
Robert Klein.
I love Robert Klein. I know he's might...
I saw it like a recent thing, and it wasn't good.
I love his delivery. Anthropomorphic. Like I love how Robert Klein delivers jokes.
Yeah,
you gotta close the wall on my Facebook page. I don't know how you do it. What do you gotta do, you guys?
You're on the phone, Rich. We're on the radio. Just text.
We're done.
Yeah, we're just about done.
Can you close the wall on my Facebook page?
Close the wall.
I really wish that I love Klein. Nothing.
What's what? The login? I can't tell that here.
Do it.
But they're just gonna keep posting.
That's not her.
You said Jenna Lee.
Yeah, I said somebody put her name up there and said it was her, but that's not her. It's the redhead on Fox. She's on like at noon, I guess.
Yeah, this is her. Monday through Friday, 11 to 1.
Who do we have tomorrow? Sorry to interrupt you.
Nobody.
No guess?
No.
When's Travis and DeRosa? Like
I'm here right now.
No, I mean Joe and Bobby.
Monday.
Oh,
Joe and Bobby are on Monday?
Yeah, for cheap.
Who's on tomorrow?
Nobody.
No one?
If both's not here, we'll probably get somebody.
Crazy ass Friday.
Yeah. If I get a hotel room, I would have came in tomorrow, but I'm playing a major golf course tomorrow.
Right. Have fun. what a day. Greg Hughes, a new dad.
Oh, yeah.
To a daughter now. Congratulations. What are you giving me?
Just some.
Oh, God.
Some coffee.
Is there anything else you wanted to talk about, or?
No.
Well, I mean.
Sure.
Just some, like, I don't know. What?
Stone Cold E.T.? I love Stone Cold E.T.
You know I'd love to talk about Stone Cold E.T.
It's so fucking stupid that it's funny.
You know what? Even though we didn't talk about it, we'll post it on our Facebook page.
You might as well.
Hell yeah.
Because it's pretty goddamn funny.
You
hell
spend
yeah.
the after show
oh,
talking
Oh, hell
about
yeah.
It.
My fucking throat. My voice is very raspy.
Been noticing
from
that.
The Yankees.
I like that.
The Yankees, who, by the way, yeah, sorry there, Trav.
I'm sorry. We're still in the playoffs.
Well, one playoff you get to play.
Who? What team?
Maybe more.
Probably what's your now. Team?
Baltimore.
I grew up a Baltimore fan.
Shut up.
So did I.
I could have gone.
I'm only playing with you, boy.
I could have gone to last night's game, but I was doing a live from the compound simulcast of the debate, which is up on Ustream.
I know what you was doing, but you this.
No, I wasn't doing that.
Fucking pecker kissing.
What?
Cocksucker.
I wasn't Pekka kissing.
You cocksucker.
You're a fucking cocksucker.
All right. Do you know about value for your money? Oh, and the dead kicks in. So
that's
natural.
Good. Yeah. I like value for my money.
Yeah. That's all I had to say. Value for the money.
Fucking big waste.
But he started music, I guess. Hey, those companies, they don't even know what that is, but Dish does. They think value is getting more for less. And that's what it is. They got packages with more channels you want to watch, more innovative features in TV. Best of all, they give it to you at a great price. Dish has the Hopper. The Hopper is a DVR that delivers HD shows to up to 4 rooms in your home. Now you can watch TV when and where you want. Hopper. They got primetime anytime. You want to record all 4 networks primetime TV automatically? You need the Hopper. Just press one button and you're never going to miss your favorite shows again. Technology is great, but Dish knows that value is about that price. Ask about packages starting at just $19.99 a month. You're going to find something that fits your life at just the right price. Stop paying more for TV and call Dish at 1-888-770-DISH. That's 1-888-770-3474. Dish, let's watch TV.
Voss just spilled all his vitamins while you were doing that.
Ah, did they fall on the floor?
All of them.
No, I spilled them on the ceiling.
I like how he said it though. No, I spilled them on the ceiling.
They fall on
You're
the floor.
Gonna take all those at the same. Oh my god! Ew. It's like 7 vitamins.
And there's floor lint on them.
Yeah.
Did you get it all?
Shit! Yeah. Yeah. I take 9-10 vitamins.
Oh, good. Good for you.
An aspirin. Baby aspirin.
Yeah. And
high blood pressure.
And vitamins. Go for
I just
you.
Do it because it makes my pee look bright yellow. It's so cool.
When your piss is looking like the inside of a glow stick.
It does. It's so
maybe
cool.
You're taking too many vitamins.
No, vitamin B makes your pee look bright yellow.
Oh, yeah?
And then if you add asparagus smell to it, it's like a fucking great day.
Just catches every sense.
Are you still doing that read?
No, I'm doing one for Hulu Plus.
Hulu Plus?
Hulu Plus. Watch all the TV you want on any device you want. Watch on your tablet, your TV, your smartphone, gaming console. Try it free right now at HuluPlus.com. Instantly stream the latest hits like Modern Family, New Girl, Bones, Glee, South Park, Tough Guy. Tough Guy? Family Guy. Tough Guy. I love that show, Tough Guy. Hey, Tough Guy. The Office, The Vampire Diaries, and a lot more. You can also catch up on current seasons of over 100 of your favorite TV shows. And they're available on Apple TV, Roku, Xbox, PS3, iPad, and a lot more. Many of Fall's newest shows are available instantly, like Revolution, Go On, Tough Guys with Kids. Oh, it's just guys with kids. And more. Go to HuluPlus.com and start your 1-week free trial today. You're just 2 clicks away from all the TV that you want to watch. On any device you want to watch it on. With Hulu Plus, Watch full series classic shows like Saturday Night Live, Chappelle Show, Lost, Arrested Development, and thousands of critically acclaimed movies and kids shows. And you'll even get access to Hulu exclusive content and Spanish language programs from Univision and plenty more. Get it all for just $7.99 a month. Yes, Hulu Plus anytime, anywhere, on any device. Start your free trial now at HuluPlus.com. I must say, what a fun time this has been. Rich Voss, any plug you want to give before?
Bananas this brief. Weekend. November 10th, Caroline's right. The movie. And my CD, Still Empty Inside, which is up for a Grammy. I like to see the numbers rise.
Oh, my
I like
God.
To see them, I'm fucking so tired. I don't know where I'm going to go now because I have from now till 8 o'clock tonight to kill.
Did I say keep it brief?
Did you? Well, here's the problem with your... Here's the thing. You don't want to... And don't end.
The Opie and Anthony Show is pretty much over. But if you feel like sticking around after ONA Live is next...